Sweep the leg. You have a problem with that? No sense. No mercy.
Get a body bag! Yeah! All right.
Hello there, and welcome to Damn Good Movie Memories. I'm your host, Brian Davis. For this episode, we're going to cover our favorite movie villains. With the caveat being that we're not going to cover superhero movies in this particular episode. You know, the thing about movie villains is you really need a strong villain in most movies. And if you don't, then the hero just can't be as successful. They can't reach their full potential. And so what we're going to try to do is find, you know, the people that we like the most. This isn't a top list. This is more like our personal favorites. And so when I read you my list, keep in mind, I know I'm missing tons of people. But again, this is what I enjoy. And when you hear the interviews, what it came to mind. And inevitably, when you're listening to this, you'll be like, well, why didn't they say this? Why did they say that? And that's the fun part about that. So if you do hear villains that you think should have been on the list, be sure to join our Facebook page or shoot us an email just saying, you know, hey, this is, why did you miss this person? Number 10 on my list is Norman Bates, played by Anthony Perkins in the classic Hitchcock film Psycho from 1960. So the thing about Norman Bates is he's not your typical villain. Obviously, if you watch the movie, you become somewhat empathetic to what's going on in his head. But yeah, it's almost like he's battling himself more than anything else. And I don't know about you, I almost didn't want him to get caught. You're almost rooting for him. So in a way, this is a kind of a different villain than traditional movies. But Anthony Perkins is amazing, and you know many feel that this Norman Bates is one of the all-time great villains, and it's hard to dispute.
Is your time so empty?
No. Well, I run the office, and tend the cabins and grounds, and do little errands for my mother, the ones she allows I might be capable of doing.
Do you go out with friends?
Well, a boy's best friend is his mother.
Number 9, it's Mr. Rooney, played by Jeffrey Jones, from Ferris Bueller's Day Off from 1986. Now, this is a kind of a fun character. He is evil in his own way, and he's kind of the epitome of a horrible principle. A little different than maybe, say, the head bad guy in The Breakfast Club, but I don't think he was a principal. I think he was like the dean of students. But in any case, Mr. Rooney, you know, in some ways, you almost feel bad for him because Ferris always gets his number. But no, he's just one bad scenario after another, and he keeps falling into all these traps that you just can't help but laugh at him. But he's so despicable that, you know, he keeps getting it every time, and you laugh every single time. But Jeffrey Jones does a really terrific job playing this character. And frankly, he's always going to be known as Mr. Rooney.
Ed Rooney. How are you today, sir?
Well, we've had a bit of bad luck this morning, as you may have heard.
Yeah, I heard, and oh, I'm all broken up. Boy, what a blow.
Yeah. Well, it's been a tough morning, and we've got a lot of family business to take care of, so if you wouldn't mind excusing Sloan, I'd appreciate it.
Sure. Yo, I'd be happy to. Yeah, you just produce a corpse, and I'll release Sloan. I want to see this dead grandmother firsthand. It's all right, Grace. It's Ferris Bueller, that little twerp. I'm going to set a trap and let him fall right into it.
Ed, I'm sorry. Did you say you wanted to see a body?
Yeah, that's right. Just roll her old bones on over here, and I'll dig up your daughter. You know that school policy.
Oh?
Was this your mother?
No, my wife's mother.
Ed Rooney's office.
Hi, this is Ferris Bueller. Can I speak to Mr. Rooney, please? Thank you.
Hold.
Tell you what, dipshit. If you don't like my policies, you can just come on down here and smooch my big old white butt.
Ed!
Pucker up, buttercup.
What? Ferris Bueller's online, too.
Number 8 is Steph, played by James Spader, in the movie Pretty in Pink from 1986. So the thing about Steph is he's just like that asshole that nobody wants to be around. He's entitled, he's arrogant, and he thinks he knows everything. And people just put up with him because he's all of that. But just the way he treats other people and the way he even treats his quote-unquote friends, he's so good as the bad kid or bad teenager in 80s films. And James Spader in general is great in this type of role. That I wouldn't say typecasted him, but he's best as the villain in most movies. But to me, his signature role will always be Stefan in Pretty in Pink.
I thought that was very uncool of you last night, Blaine.
What?
What?
You mean Andy?
Yeah, I mean Andy.
What's a big deal? I like her. Matter of fact, I was pissed off at you guys for being so nasty to her.
It was way out of order for you to foist her on the party.
Steph, you hear yourself? You hear the same asshole shit I hear?
What, do I have to spell it out for you, Blaine?
I guess so.
Nobody appreciates your sense of humor, you know. As a matter of fact, everybody's just about to puke from you. You know, if you got a hard-on for trash, don't take care of it around those pal, right?
Right, buddy.
Listen, I don't need a lot of shit on this one, Blaine, all right? I really don't.
Money all that matters to you.
Where the hell does that come from? Come on, look around. Would I treat my parents' house like this if my money was any kind of issue? Well, why are you doing this? You know, why don't you just nail her and get it over with? You know, why are you getting involved?
Is there something wrong with that?
I just think it's stupid. You know, it's pointless. And your parents, I think they'll be thrilled.
They have nothing to do with it.
Really?
Yeah.
I've seen your mother go to work on you, Blaine. You know, it's vicious. And when Bill and Joyce get through with you, you won't know where the shit to go sail. Listen, I'm getting really bored with this conversation, all right, Blaine? You know, if you want your little piece of low-grade ass, fine, take it, you know. But if you do, you're not going to have a friend.
Is that right?
Yeah, that's right. I mean, if you want to make the choice, go ahead and make it, all right? I personally wouldn't trash a friendship over it, but, hey, like fashion, so. Let's take a shower. You look like shit.
Number 7 is Mr. Potter, played by Lionel Barrymore, and It's a Wonderful Life from 1946. The thing about Mr. Potter is, like, he is probably the epitome of you know, that despicable person that you remember, and it's really classic because, you know, that's the type of villain that kind of, it never goes away. The sheer greed and not caring about his fellow man, you know, still resonates to this day. I often go to the Stanford Theater in Palo Alto, California, on Christmas Eve, because they have been doing showings of It's a Wonderful Life for probably the past 25 years. And every time that Mr. Potter comes on screen, like clockwork, everyone hisses. And it's amusing to watch, but he really, you know, resonates with the crowd. And that's the epitome of a good villain. Having James Stewart's character survive after being put through the ringer from Mr. Potter makes it that much better. Makes the payoff that much better. And Lionel Barrymore is just simply awesome. There's a guy that could pretty much play any role. He could be the happy-go-lucky dad, and You Can't Take It With You, but he could also play the heavy villain in It's a Wonderful Life.
Well, what's your point, Mr. Potter?
My point is I want to hire you.
Hire?
I want you to manage my affairs, run my properties. George, I'll start you out at $20,000 a year.
$20,000 a year?
You wouldn't mind living in the nicest house in town, buying your wife a lot of fine clothes, a couple of business trips to New York a year, maybe once in a while Europe. You wouldn't mind that, would you, George?
Would I?
You're not talking to somebody else around here, are you? You know, this is me. You remember me? George Bailey.
George Bailey. George Bailey, whose ship has just come in. Provided he has enough brains to climb aboard.
Holy mackerel. Well, how about the building and loan?
Oh, confounded man, are you afraid of success? I'm offering you a 3 years contract at $20,000 a year starting today. Is it a deal or isn't it?
Well, Mr. Potter, I know I ought to jump at the chance, but I wonder if it would be possible for you to give me 24 hours to think it over.
Sure. You go on home and talk about it to your wife.
I'd like to do that.
Yeah. In the meantime, I'll draw up the papers.
All right, sir.
Okay, George.
Okay, Mr. Potter.
Wait a minute here. Wait a minute. I don't need 24 hours. I don't have to talk to anybody. I know right now, and the answer's no, no! Doggone it. You sit around here and you spin your little webs and you think the whole world revolves around you and your money. Well, it doesn't, Mr. Potter. In the whole vast configuration of things, I'd say you were nothing but a scurvy little spider. And that goes for you, too. And it goes for you, too!
Number 6, The Fratellis, played by Ann Ramsey, Robert Davi, and Joey Pants, in The Goonies from 1985. So the thing about, and this is the first one I chose, it's like actually a group, but really they all kind of go together. Much like Mr. Rooney and Ferris Bueller's Day Off, this is a comedy. But still, you know, even in a comedy you can have villains, and in this case, the Fratellis are so good, but they're still creepy and scary at the same time. And you know, obviously the way they treat Sloth, you're really rooting for the kids and for Sloth to get even with them. And then the payoff at the end is just as good. It would have been interesting to have even more of a backstory just on the Fratellis. But they're some of the best villains in comedy movies that I've ever witnessed.
These boys are customers.
Ma questo è il nome ristorante.
Zitta, zitta, stupida, non capisce niente.
Va bene, mamma, ho capito. Boys, mi ti sono scappato, ma butto fuori questi stringetti, eh? Ci sono cookies.
What do you want?
Four waters.
Is that all?
No.
I want the Venus Scallopine. I want a fettuccine Alfredo. A bottle of fettuccine a 1981.
The only thing we serve is tongue. You boys like tongue?
Number 5 is Hannibal Lecter, played by Anthony Hopkins in Silence of the Lambs from 1991. So this is a tough one, and Hannibal Lecter is referred to many times in interviews coming up. And, you know, it would be easy to say Buffalo Bill, and actually Buffalo Bill is the real main villain. But it's easy to forget that Hannibal Lecter is not a good guy. But Anthony Hopkins is just so good. And even though he is a villain, you're almost rooting for him because there's a villain that's even worse in Buffalo Bill. But that being said, there's so much depth to Anthony Hopkins' character, and nobody could have played the role as good as he did. There was a movie that came out in 1986 called Manhunter, which was basically Silence of the Lambs, completely different characters, and Hannibal Lecter is barely in it. There could be no other actor that could play Hannibal Lecter better than Anthony Hopkins.
Oh, agents, darling, you think you can dissect me with this blunt little tool?
No. I thought that your knowledge...
You're so ambitious, aren't you? Do you know what you look like to me with your good bag and your cheap shoes? You look like a robe. A well-scrubbed, hustling robe with a little taste. Good nutrition's given you some length of bone, but you're not more than one generation from poor white trash, are you, Agent Starling? And that accent you've tried so desperately to shed, pure West Virginia. What is your father dear? Is he a coal miner? Does he stink of the land? You know how quickly the boys found you, all those tedious, sticky fumblings in the back seats of cars, while you could only dream of getting out, getting anywhere, getting all the way to the FBI.
You see a lot, Doctor. But are you strong enough to point that high power? power to perception it yourself. What about it? Why don't you look at yourself and write down what you see?
A census taker once tried to test me. I ate his liver with some fava beans and a nice Chianti.
Number 4 is Mr. Hart, played by Dabney Coleman, in 9 to 5 from 1980. Now, this might seem like an oddball choice to you, but if you've never seen 9 to 5, I mean, this is the epitome of a bad, bad boss. The famous line said by Jane Fonda is that he's a sexist, egotistical, lying, hypocritical bigot. And that is him. That is his character summed up in basically 5 or 6 words. When I was a kid, I had no idea what any of those words meant, but I knew he was a bad guy. And it just made the payoff at the end with the three women, Jane Fonda, Dolly Parton, and Lily Tomlin, just made it that much better because he deserved everything he got, and really kind of set the role for eventually other bad bosses and that you'll hear about later on this podcast. But no, Dabney Coleman is so good, and he really owns his character, and I can't imagine anyone playing Franklin Hart better than Dabney Coleman.
I'd like to thank Judy. If there is a word to describe my philosophy of business, it's teamwork. Everybody working together. You girls, of course, never got a chance to play football or baseball. And I've always felt like that's unfortunate because I think it's probably the best place to learn what teamwork is all about. I remember Coach Fry used to tell us, a chain is only as strong as its weakest link. Its weakest link. God damn it.
Can I get this chair fixed?
Well, I'm not going to bore you with a long harangue. Just suffice to say that it is a jungle out there, but if we all work together, we can cut the balls off the competition, be sitting pretty right on top of the hill.
Thank you, sir. I'm happy to be working here.
Well, you're a welcome addition, and a damn pretty one, too, if I might add.
Thank you, sir.
Now, I mean that. You should see some of the crones that have been coming through here lately. Real pathetic. Right, Violet? Oh, Violet, by the way, my wife is coming by later on. I'd like to get her a little present. Could you pick her out a nice scarf or something?
Mr. Hart, we've discussed this before. I don't think it's my place to shop.
Violet, goddammit, you know, I've been standing up here for 5 minutes talking about teamwork, and the first thing I know, you're not there for the handoff.
All I'm saying, Mr. Hart, is that my job description doesn't say anything about making purchases for your wife.
And all I'm saying is that I like people around me who are flexible and get along. So when I ask an employee, especially one who wants to be promoted to management, I expect a little cooperation. You savvy?
Savvy.
Good. And we're talking silk, blue, maybe a little red stripe.
You're talking to the right person.
Violet's the best. First person I met at the company. Knows more about what's going on here than anybody but Mr. Hinkle.
Oh, a deer.
Yeah, lucky shot. But Judy, listen, if you ever have anything of a serious nature on your mind at all, I want you to feel free to come in here and talk to me about it, because that's actually why I have my office on this floor, is to be close to my girls. Okay?
Certainly. Thank you.
Okay. Oh, is Dora Lee back yet?
No.
Well, get me a little coffee then, Violet. No sugar, just a little skinny and sweet.
Yes, sir. Well, that's Franklin Hart, Jr. But to me, he'll always be F. Hart.
Number 3 is Doyle Lonergan, played by Robert Shaw, from The Sting, from 1973. Now, The Sting is one of the all-time greatest movies, hands down. I mean, it is quite possibly a perfect film. And that's saying a lot, considering it came after Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid. But I think, you know, even though Paul Newman and Robert Redford are amazing, especially Paul Newman, what carries, not carries the film, but what really is the glue that really pieces everything together, in addition to all the great character actors, is Robert Shaw. Because Lonergan is just a ball breaker, and he's got that terrific Irish brogue, and he just makes it that much better because you're really rooting for these guys to nail him, and the payoff is that much better. But he is so good. Robert Shaw was good in almost everything he was in. Of course, people remember him as Quint in Jaws, and he's almost like kind of the anti-hero in that too. But playing Doyle Lonergan, that is one of his all-time best roles.
Tough luck, Ron Ann. But a
That's what you get for playing with your head up your ass. A couple more like that, we can all go to bed early.
Name's Lonergan. Doyle Lonergan. You're gonna remember that, Mr. Shaw. You're gonna get yourself another game. You follow?
Number two is Clubber Lang, played by Mr. T in the movie Rocky III from 1982. Now, there's a few villains in Rocky III, one being Hulk Hogan, who plays the notorious Thunder Lips in the wrestling scene that Sylvester Stallone does for charity. But really, Mr. T is so bad, bad meaning good and bad meaning bad, in the film that they have to get Apollo Creed to team up with Rocky in order to defeat Mr. T. I just loved all the lines in it, and he's so perfect in that role because you just really want Rocky to beat him, but you don't know if he can. So I always loved Mr. T, and I loved him so much that once after I saw this, then I really got into the A-Team and B.A. Baracus. And so, yeah, so Mr. T, definitely one of the best villains on my list.
No, I don't hate Balboa, but I pity the fool. And I will destroy any man who tries to take what I got.
What's your prediction for the fight, then?
Prediction?
Yes, prediction.
Pain.
And number one on my list of favorite movie villains, it's a double pick, and it's Johnny Lawrence and John Kreese, played by William Zabka and Martin Cove from The Karate Kid from 1984. Now, if you remember, Kreese is the evil sensei, and so while Johnny definitely wreaks havoc and makes Daniel-san's life a living hell, it really all stems from the evil sensei, played by Kreese. They don't learn any of this bad stuff unless it was from him. And so while, yes, Johnny tortures Daniel nonstop, it really comes from Kreese. And so to see, sweep the leg, you got a problem with that, no mercy. That is still one of my all-time favorite lines. And it just makes, and then you have the evil, spooky music in the background. It's so good. So while, yeah, I mean, it takes a lot from Rocky with the underdog story, those two guys were the epitome of 80s bad guys, especially William Zabka, who then went on to play the bad guy in Just One of the Guys. And then he played the teenage bad guy in the movie Back to School, which Rodney Dangerfield was in. So he kind of got typecast in the bad guy role, but he played it so well that, come on, I mean, it would have been better as Johnny. So yes, that is my top 10 list of my favorite movie villains. Enjoy everyone else's interviews, and I'll come back later.
All right, so we're here with Sarah Macris, who has been my friend and best hairstylist I've known for over 10 years.
Yeah, I'm thinking 12.
Thinking 12? Mm-hmm. Okay. So we, the great part of when I get my hair cut is that
it's not long enough.
Well, yeah, that's exactly right. Because all we ended up talking about is movies and just random stuff.
Right.
And so we could basically have a podcast on our own.
Right.
And so this might be the start of something.
This is a good thing.
So I decided.
I think we're hilarious.
I think we're hilarious too. This
I feel
might
bad
just be
for
the whole show.
People don't listen to us.
We better promote then after this.
I totally will.
So what we're going to do is we're going to just discuss movies with Sarah. And the first one we're going to go through is what is your favorite villain or villains in movies? Because I'm sure you have a lot.
Okay. I'm not like the big, comic book movie. I know everyone's like, Batman. I don't really care.
I think that could be its own episode.
Right. That totally could. So
non-superhero.
Non-scary movie, because that's what I came up with a few of them. But then I was like, trying to remember the time I'm watching a movie and I'm like, God, I hate that guy.
Yeah.
Like I can't swear, right?
You can do whatever you want.
I was like, that guy's a dick. So the one of the first ones I came up with was the warden from Shawshank Redemption. Because for me, it's like when that person gets theirs at that point in the movie, when you're all, yes. Like, when the cops come and that's when you know, like, okay. I kind of like the justice in that, whether they're a good villain or not. But I'm like, okay, everybody needs to get theirs because it's not cool. But
that's the epitome of a really good actor and villain. You have to hate them enough for the payoff to be that good.
Exactly.
And that definitely, he was vicious.
Yeah. But in the same note, with hating a villain John Travolta is another one that came to me, is that he is so good. I could hate him, but then I still like him in everything else. Like, I still look at him, I'm like, oh, he's great in something. And maybe that's not good because I'm watching him thinking I still like him even though he's an asshole.
Yeah.
But he's pretty good at, like, keeping people, you know, impressed. He impresses me on either end.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I'll always watch a movie that he's in, as sure. opposed to Tom Cruise and Angelina, I'll avoid all the time.
Whether they're good
care.
Or bad.
I don't even care if you paid me for free in my neighbor's garage. I wouldn't watch Angelina movies.
What if we get him on the podcast? You're not going to listen?
Maybe. Oh, yeah, for sure.
Okay.
For sure.
Okay.
Can I make fun of him?
Of course you can make fun of him. Then that will be the last time they're on the show.
Because he's 4 feet tall.
Yes.
So
those are the two main ones.
Well, for now.
Yeah. So did you come up with any other ones?
Well, I came, and this is not a person necessarily, but it was the alien from
Alien.
The Alien movies. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It just, because, and there's never a point to where you ever think, unlike the Anthony Perkins from Psycho, where you're like, he's whack.
Yeah.
But I feel bad because he has issues and his mom jacked him up.
It's true.
Or like Hannibal Lecter,
yep.
who's a great villain, but he's so charming.
Yeah.
And you're like, I totally would let you eat my face off. I don't care.
Well, that, and he's not even the worst villain because of
right.
Buffalo Bill.
Right.
So, yeah.
But then, what was it? And was it Red Dragon? Was that this? No, which? No, Hannibal, the rich guy that he ends up feeding to the pigs.
Yes, yes.
And that was, I love that actor. Anyway, he's another, what's his name?
I'll have to go back and fact
okay.
check. But yes.
Anyway, normally I know that one. But he in Hannibal, he's a charming wacko.
Yeah.
But the alien, like, character, the actual alien in all the Sigourney Weaver, Ridley Scott movies.
Yeah.
Like, he designed it like a spider. And it would across the floor.
Yeah.
And you don't know where it is. And then it freaking latches onto your face. It's the last thing you ever want. You know, it's like I have a dentist come at me, don't come near me. And then you're just, it just skeeves me out. That's all.
I think we might have to do an interview just about your dentist experience. Oh. That would be good. Yeah.
He doesn't like me anymore.
Because everything's an alien.
Right, so. Well, don't come near me.
Okay, so other villains, did you have any?
God, you know what? I know there's some will probably
come
to me as you're speaking,
okay.
And then I'll totally interrupt.
That's fine.
Okay.
So we're going to go back. So since you're coming into the fourth episode.
Okay.
And I definitely want to.
Because I'm late always.
That's
my signature move.
So why? This is your first, but it's the fourth episode.
Right.
We're going to, because I'm sure you have great answers for all these. What was the first movie you actually saw in the theater?
I'm pretty sure it was. The timing's so close. It was either Quest for Fire,
right,
which I really didn't care a whole lot about when you're like six, and the movie broke at the end.
No
and
way.
People lost their shit. They were like, it probably about 10 minutes till the end, and I just remember being like, was that part of the movie? Like, what's going on? And then E.T., of course.
Okay.
Which I can remember it being really sad, my cousin crying, my sister crying, and me just being like, are you going to eat that?
A lot of people said E.T. Well, that was my first movie,
really?
Too.
And, I remember going, and so, but I'm pretty sure it was probably something I didn't want to see, or it was probably Quest for Fire in the movie theater. Drive-in was Private Benjamin.
That's awesome.
Which I ended up watching something on the screen in silent next to me, because I was like, what is this?
I love Goldie Hawn 80s movies.
But when I was like five, I couldn't appreciate it.
No, not at all.
Now I'm like, I love it. It was great. It was funny. So
it's a funny thing. So movie breaking, that happened to me watching Showgirls when I was 17.
You saw that at a theater.
At a theater.
But you were 17, so
money.
Now we're okay.
So this...
Were you the only one in the theater?
No, there were plenty, because everyone wanted to see Elizabeth Berkley without her clothes on.
Right, right, right.
So, 17.
And to see what it's like to, like, what it must have been like in the 70s when you had to go to
pretty
a
much watch
in the theater.
An X-rated
right.
film.
Right.
Yeah, so, but halfway through, it started to flicker, and then it was like the Gremlins, like the whole thing.
Oh, melted away.
Yeah, and so we're all like, is this part of the movie? Like, this is awful.
It's like apparently the guys who ran the movie theater watched it.
A bit too much.
Prior.
That's. I didn't even think about that. That's a good point. So we got a free movie out of it. I still don't know how it ends, though. So
it pretty much ends as stupidly as it started.
So you have seen
it. So you're good.
Okay.
Yeah, I
good.
Have seen it. Because everybody's been hungover on a couch all day, like trying to, having nothing to do but be like, I just lost 2 hours of my life. I might as well watch Elizabeth Berkley.
And you didn't get a refund either. So.
No, but it was free at least. I don't know if it was on Skinamax or like HBO or whatever. But I was like,
is Cinemax still a station?
It is still a station. I don't get it because I'm not that cool, but it doesn't. It's like, yeah, and so is the movie channel, which I don't get either.
Right.
I only get the other budget ones.
The Encore?
Encore, yeah. HBO, Showtime, I pay $10 for. Yeah. And as you can see, after I upgraded my new boxes, I haven't returned them because I'm like, if they call me, I'm going to be like, guess what? Your new ones don't work so well. So anyway, but I
And where's my Cinemax?
Yeah.
Okay, so we got through. Okay, what is your favorite horror movie? I know you're way into scary sci-fi.
The one that scarred me the most to this day would be the Alligator movie from like 1982.
That's awesome.
Because my sister and I won't go anywhere near a pool if the sun is starting to go down. Mm-hmm. Like something's wrong in there. It's funny. I'm not a big gory slasher. Like that kind of maybe kind of grosses me out a little bit. Like those Saw movies I won't see.
Yeah.
Of course, I've seen Friday the 13th and all those. And it's pretty much... It's funny, though, to me because, one, the soundtrack is what makes it scary. Him and Michael Myers, you turn it on mute and you're like, okay, weirdo white guys in masks.
Yeah.
I don't care. But it's like the formula is pretty much like, okay, you have five people, young people, chicks wear no bras,
mm-hmm.
and they go for midnight swims when three people are already missing. And it's like, is that you? Is that you, Jeff? No, it's a weirdo guy with a freaking machete. So,
but that's wasn't that the point of like the early Friday? It was like it was you were having teenage sex,
right? And that's what you're gonna die
if
you do that. So they were it's basically like the old you'll go blind if you masturbate.
Exactly. Yes.
Yeah. But they were doing. But if you watch them now, when's the last time you saw one of those?
Year. It's probably 10 years. 10, 15.
I only like this. I like movies that are spooky, but maybe kind of could be true. You know, like I remember watching like The Sixth Sense or things like that, where
mm-hmm.
at the end you're like. Holy shit.
Yeah.
Or whatever. But I remember I think it was the first or second Friday the 13th when all of a sudden you realize, like, you see him flashing back to his mom.
Yes.
And then he looks, and then you feel kind of sad for him.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Because really the hockey mask didn't come into the
second. When they dug
third.
Him up.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. How many, you know, there's what, 13 of those?
God, yeah. Yeah. I've only really seen, I think, the first four or five.
Yeah, because you have a life.
Yes. Thank you, Sarah.
And
Thank
you don't play Dungeons and Dragons.
I don't.
All
I,
night.
Yes.
Yeah. So,
our audience might, but that's
Yeah. The horror movie I'm trying to think of, I know there's probably some good scary ones, but that, but I'm not a big, you know, I like, if it could be real, so again, it could have to be something that's a little more spooky rather than slasher.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's so many.
But it's so funny you said Alligator. Someone, Malin, on our podcast, when you have to listen, he picked Alligator.
Have you ever watched the trailer for those old movies?
Oh, they're
the
great.
Guy who's on them?
Yeah.
Like who does
it's the same
it's
voice.
It's a movie
yeah.
from. I'm like, whoa. It kind of, it's almost like, now it's not funny. Now it's not good anymore because it was so kind of cheesy at the time.
Yeah.
But, I don't know. Do you have a scary movie?
Because
generally how this works is when you're getting your haircut, you say something that all of a
sudden
makes
something.
My ADD
That's
go. and the original thing that we were talking about, it's like way off yonder. And I'm like, well, okay, what were we talking about in the beginning? How did I get over here?
So I don't really like super, super scary. It's not that I'm scared of them,
you're
but
scared.
I enjoy.
Let's just be honest.
Okay, fine. I enjoy the original Universal horror films, like the original Dracula and the original.
Oh.
Not because they're scary, just because I like the films.
Right, right, right.
They were kind of scary when I was a kid.
I did watch Interview with the Vampire like 17 times
right.
when it was on like HBO back in whatever, 90 something.
Right.
Even though I hate Tom Cruise, don't tell anybody about that. I guess I did, yeah. But
you like Brad Pitt, so.
I like Brad Pitt when he's playing crazy.
Right.
Way better than anything
else. So, like,
12
Monkeys.
12 Monkeys was great. Fight Club.
Yeah.
He also was something about anything where somebody plays a little loony, that's where I'm like, I like him.
Yeah.
Or just off kilter. Not to quote, what's his name, like, whatever. I never even saw that
movie. Tropic Thunder.
Right.
Yes.
But, like, Dustin Hoffman was, like, Rain Man. I'll watch it every time it's on.
Sure.
And I remember, like, Leonardo DiCaprio, before he blew up, he did What's Eating Gilbert Grape.
Right.
He was, like, 19.
Yes.
And he actually got an Oscar nomination, nobody knows. And I remember watching that movie. My dad's like, how do they get that retarded kid to act on cue?
Yeah.
I'm like, Dad, he's not retarded. He's like, are you shitting me? And I go, no, Dad, he's not.
He's that good.
He's that good.
Yes.
And my dad even said, yeah, him and Dustin Hoffman. I'm like, yep.
Well, the quote in Tropic Thunder is, you don't go full retard.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And there's a very fine line where you can play. Like, it's like I remember people who played who were pretending to be blind.
Yes.
If you do that well, okay. If you're, you know.
Yeah, Al Pacino.
Yes. That's exactly what I was going to say. Mm-hmm. And if, you know, you can do a little bit off, like Benny and June, you know, they're kind of off. It was good. That's, you didn't go like, totally off.
Yeah.
And I think Sean Penn tried it in a movie. And
I Am Sam, but it didn't work.
Work out.
I think that was the quote.
Yeah.
Because
he didn't work
full.
That right.
Yeah.
But Dustin Hoffman did it really well. So anyway, that's another show.
Yes, it totally is. This is the way we go. Okay. So that's off the list. Okay. What was the worst movie you saw on a date?
Okay. People go to the movies on dates.
Yes.
I didn't even know they still do that. I just thought it was Netflix and chill.
It kind of is, but we're going to go
I don't. I've never had the Netflix and chill. I have Netflix. I'm waiting for the chill. So actually, it was kind of recently because I saw that. What's that magician movie? Now You See Me.
Oh yeah,
with the second
you
one.
You saw the second one. Had you seen the first one?
I did see the first one, and I liked it, which is why. And that's the other thing. I won't go to something that I haven't seen. I won't watch something if I haven't seen the first one, which is probably really irritating to some people.
Yeah.
I also won't watch something if it started like 2 minutes ago. I'm like, I can't miss anything. I'm not watching it. I got to record it anyway. So I saw that, and I was on a date, and I just was like, even though you're not talking, you know, you're sitting next to somebody that you're like, oh my God, this is like 2 hours of my life. I'm never getting back. And like, can I fake an injury and throw myself down those little steps that are only about 3-inch rise? I don't know. Is it going to be obvious? But then I was at Oak Ridge, and it's kind of like not really convenient to get, because he drove. And so
was this a first date or was it?
No, it was somebody that I'd already like hung out with before, but I just was over it. I'm like, and so I was just like, yeah.
It's not happening.
Yeah, exactly. And it's funny because he's texted me since then. And I'm like, yeah, crickets.
I got nothing for you.
I got nothing for you.
So it was like magic. You just magically disappeared.
Exactly. Yeah. And the movie was just, if the movie was good, maybe I would have not been so aware of the fact that I was with somebody I didn't want to be with. But yeah, thank God I didn't have to speak much. But and I want to say that's one of the only times I've gone on a date with somebody and like to a movie. I don't.
So even back in high school.
Because I'm a talker. Can you imagine how well that... No, in high school I didn't date. In high school I didn't date.
You didn't go any, like, just as...
No. I've gone to, movies with friends that were just platonic.
Sure.
Actually, my friend Chris and I went to go see Fox Catcher,
yes.
That one with Steve.
Yes.
Which was phenomenal, I thought. Anyway, so
yeah,
we went into the wrong theater, and it was something with, like, Ethan Hawke and, like, some six-year movie, I don't know. And we're sitting there, and I'm like, it's like a couple minutes in, I'm like, dude, what, are we in the right movie theater? And so he goes, hold on, and he goes, he walks out, he comes back in, he's all, nope, we're not in the
So what did you, end up not even watching?
No, we got up, luckily ours hadn't started yet, so it was like a few minutes, you know, between, and so we went in and watched that, and I'm about 15 minutes into the movie, and I'm like, I thought you said Steve Carell was in this. And he's like, yeah, I know, that's what I thought too. And I couldn't even recognize him, because he was so like, that, which is a sign of somebody who's, he was good, creepy. And
yeah.
Because he's always so funny. Oh, that's another subject altogether. Because
yeah.
he's always so funny, I have a hard time with people, like, you know, and he pulled it off. For
yeah.
me. Like, I don't think Will Ferrell will ever be able to trick me into being somebody who's not an idiot.
Right.
I just
what about Jim Carrey?
He can be, like, a depressed idiot.
Yeah.
But I still, I'm like, God, it's like, all I'm going to see is Fire Marshal Bill.
Yeah,
always,
it's
you
true.
Know? Right. And so I think, like, they say that about Jennifer Aniston is always playing Rachel Green.
Yeah.
Alas, but that's, you know, it's like, someone's like, oh, no, she did what? Derailed them all. She was Rachel Green on, like, Xanax and maybe a little bit slutty. Like, that's
actually,
it.
That's another great topic. We
right.
can do actors that can never get out of their stereotypical
role. Yeah, they're
role.
The same person.
Yeah.
Always.
Yeah.
That's like, even on TV, it's like Mad Men. I love that show.
Yeah.
But I'm really not convinced that
John Hamm
is
yeah.
acting. I'm just thinking he's walking
just,
around being himself,
right.
kind of, you know, an alcoholic dick or something.
Yes.
I'd still make out with him, but he just kind of, you're like,
I will let you know when we get John Hamm
yeah,
on the show.
Yeah, can you?
Yes.
Can you let me know?
We will do that.
Can I sit on his lap?
You can.
Okay, he'll probably say no.
Thanks,
not appropriate.
Sarah.
I think he's great.
I'm sure by now you've heard a terrible thing. A man that young, less than a year ago, trying to escape, broke Cat Madley's heart to shoot him. Truly it did. We just have to put it behind us. Move on.
I'm telling you, everything stops. Someone else during your scams.
Nothing stops. Nothing. You will do the hardest time there is. No more protection from the guards. I'll pull you out of that one bunk, Hilton, and cast you down with the sodomites. In the library. Gone. Sealed off, brick by brick. We'll have us a little book barbecue in the yard. We'll see the flames for miles. We'll dance around it like wild Indians. You understand me? Catch my drift. Or am I being obtuse?
Okay, we're going to do some of our infamous, famous, whatever we want to call it, roundtable interviews. So for here, we have my other brother, Brian. Brian. We have Linley, super producer. Who doesn't produce?
Yeah, exactly. Thank you.
And Samantha. All right. So for this episode, we're going to do your favorite movie villain that isn't a superhero. So we'll start with Brian.
All right.
What do you got?
Well, I made a list of top three. And my probably,
I do have to mention that Darth Vader is my favorite villain, but I'm not going to talk about him because he's kind of a supernatural guy, so we won't talk about him. But
okay.
I, for the record, that is my favorite villain.
Duly noted.
But so my number one otherwise is Khan from Star Trek II, Ricardo Montalban, who I just, I mean, at the time I thought he was cool and scary, and now it's kind of more like a cheese factor, but I think it's great. You have a villain who's like super smart, he's strong, and he's quoting Shakespeare, and he's just getting in the way of everything that Captain Kirk tries to do, and he like... He has the bugs that he puts in people's ears to control their mind. Yeah. It's just like, I mean, from right off the bat, that's kind of the first thing he does in the movie. And it's like, okay, this guy is not, you know, messing around.
That freaked me out the most in that movie.
Yeah,
like, I couldn't watch
definitely. Like, after that, I was like, okay, this guy is bad.
Yeah. And he has an amazing mullet.
Yes.
And he had the fake chest.
Yeah, he's got got the wrestler chest.
Yeah.
With the grease and everything. I mean,
yes. So yeah, that is amazing.
Pretty classic villain.
And thank you for picking this, because now I know exactly what the movie scene interlude is going to be to the next interview. So. Yes, exactly. Would you like to? No.
I won't enact it.
All right.
Any of Khan's quotes would work well.
It's
too.
True.
Yeah.
He's excellent. All right, so what's number two?
My number two is HAL 9000 from 2001.
That's a great one.
That's a good one.
It's not a person, but an AI, and it's, you know, still relevant today as we get more and more AI in our daily lives.
Did you like the how they had kind of a HAL homage in Airplane 2?
I'm trying to remember Airplane 2. I do remember. I like that movie. They go to the, and I don't. What does he do?
So to connect the Star Trek connection here, which. There kind of is one.
Yeah.
Shatner plays the character.
He's
like,
on the
he's
moon.
On the moon.
Base, right?
Yes, he's the kind of the Robert Stack character.
Yeah,
So,
okay.
Yes.
Yeah, no, yeah. I mean, I remember. Yeah, I vaguely remember Airplane. I remember Airplane, the first Airplane, more. But yeah, I don't know. HAL was just amazing because it's just like this cold, unfeeling thing until like the end where Dave is deactivating him and you start to see like almost this emotion in HAL, where it's, you know, I feel my mind is going, Dave, and he's,
right.
He sings the song, and it's just like, oh, this is kind of creepy. And
so how many times did it take for you to watch 2001 before you totally got it, or do you even still get it? Because I don't.
I probably like 3 or 4 times.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if I watch it again, I probably say, oh, wait, maybe I don't get it after all. I don't know. The whole ending, I don't know if I get it, honestly. But
have you guys seen
up until he goes into hyperspace, I think it's a straightforward movie with HAL as the villain.
Yeah.
And then after that, it's kind of
that
more,
is more
open to interpretation,
right.
Yeah.
I'd say.
Oh, is there an interpretation? That's where they could have used an editor.
Maybe.
That's really long.
Yeah.
All right, and so what's your third one?
My third one is, this is kind of, well, it's Michael Corleone from Godfather 2, where he's sort of a hero and the villain at the same time.
Yeah, he's kind of the anti-hero.
Because he's basically screwing over his family a lot. Like,
yeah.
He cuts off his wife at the end, he kills his brother.
Yep.
Yes.
He's...
Fredo.
Kind of,
yes.
Yeah, poor Fredo. You have to kill Fredo.
Oh, Fredo.
Poor Fredo.
He's fishing with your son, too. He's poor Fredo. He's doing the Senate testimony, and they the Senate had the informant, Frankie Pentangeli,
mm-hmm.
who Michael turns back onto his side by using Frankie's older brother, who like has some kind of weird voodoo influence over Frankie.
Yeah.
So it's just like all the manipulation you see play out throughout the movie, and it's like you see it in parallel to Vito, and you see like Vito is more like, he's kind of protecting his own and his own interests, and Michael's doing that too, but it's also, it's just kind of a way more manipulative way, and it's just kind of, it just becomes darker as it goes on.
Yeah, and I think that's the fascinating part about it too, was that you really see the rise and the
mm-hmm.
the power goes to his head. And,
yeah.
Do you like two better than one?
I think I like one slightly better, but mm-hmm. they're to me, they're kind of like a pair, and I love them both.
Right.
So they're just like two of my favorites.
Well, that's why, I mean, at least you lose Brando in two, but
you get
De Niro.
Yeah.
Basically says like 5 lines. To him,
that's
but
true.
That's how good he is. I mean, that's
yeah.
him and Bruno Kirby plays his buddy
when
they steal the rug. Or,
yeah.
Yeah. So that was great.
Yeah. Okay, Winley. Those are great. Thank you, Brian. So.
Yeah, mine are no good. I don't have anything good to say. You'll have to edit this out. What did I say before? I forget. Okay, I was thinking about this. Beetlejuice.
That's great.
Beetlejuice.
That's a great one.
That's one of my favorite movies. I love Beetlejuice.
Okay, so how many times have you seen Beetlejuice?
Oh, we watch it
Beetlejuice,
annually.
Beetlejuice.
Yeah.
Yeah,
well, we watch it annually as part of our Halloween, you know, movie extravaganza, so... Yeah, we just
I've
watched it.
I've seen Exorcist 57 times. It keeps getting funnier every single time.
Oh, The Mother and Carrie. That's another good film.
You and Carrie. It always goes back to Carrie.
No,
oh, that mother's a creep.
Right.
Yeah.
She was terrible. That's what I was thinking of. Psycho.
Yeah.
Norman Bates, but not. But I empathize with Norman Bates. Isn't it the mother who's the awful one, right? I mean, he killed her, and then he went on to kill other people. Wasn't that the interpretation that killed the mother?
Yeah, I guess. But this and the endings, I mean, that's why Psycho's so great, because it's her voice.
I know, right?
And then,
yeah.
Like, I haven't even heard a fly.
Yeah, exactly. Him thinking her voice.
Yes.
Right.
Okay, to give away a little bit, but anyone listening to this will have already heard my top 10 list. That is number 10 for mine, is Norman Bates.
Oh, it is?
Yes.
I'm sorry.
No,
no.
Steal
your thunder.
You don't know that. No. Actually, I'm stealing your thunder.
Darth Vader, though. I understand that's kind of ubiquitous, and why would you
But true, he's the
Darth
ultimate
Vader.
Villain.
Or even the Stormtroopers. I told you, they really scared me. I had a recurring nightmare about Stormtroopers taking over my elementary school.
So, Brian, to the listening audience, Brian has a Stormtrooper.
Now they're kind of lovable. And then so I already told you guys the story. You were all sitting there. Sorry, you have to hear my stories. Repeated. When I took my son to Disneyland, now they have Stormtroopers, right, as the characters, with Darth Vader came walking, you know, swooshing by, and literally, I mean, I was kind of like, even though it's ridiculous, these are people dressed up as Stormtroopers, but still, like, the child inside of me was still a little fearful, because they're pretty, it's cool costumes,
it's
right?
Yeah,
it's like they're full.
How
did
you even survive October? You're admittedly afraid of everything.
No, I mean, the ones I watch with my kids are more like Beetlejuice level. I don't really get fearful.
Okay, so
not
Beetlejuice is your favorite villain. Wait, oh, from
Beetlejuice.
Dr. Evil, you said, was...
Oh, I said Dr. Evil.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, Dr. Evil. Yeah, you know.
Okay, so what about Dr. Evil? You gotta...
It's just a funny portrayal. I don't know. I don't go beyond comedies, really. I don't watch it. And then we said the Nazis in any movie.
Yeah, it's true. The Nazis are usually bad in every movie. I can't think of a good...
And in real life.
Yeah. Yes, in real life, too, Winley. Are there any comedies with Nazis in them? Because
Mel Brooks comedies with Nazis in them.
Right.
Yeah.
To Be or Not to Be, which actually Mel Brooks remade, but the original one with Jack Benny.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I
so
haven't seen the original one with Jack Benny.
Basically, they're actors that have to act a part. Because
okay.
I think they're in Poland.
Right.
But they never mind Polish accents. But that basically they have to, it's a comedy about getting away from the Nazis.
That's fine.
Yes.
Well, I was thinking about Inglorious Bastards.
That's
for this.
True. Yeah,
because
he
Hans whatever his face, he's like really horrible,
horrible,
frightening person, but he's kind of funny.
Yeah.
At the same time, kind of like awkward.
Samantha just reminded me by saying Hans Gruber from Die Hard is probably like an all-time classic.
So thank you for mentioning that. I unfortunately had to replace him on my list with Norman Bates.
Oh,
you
kicked him
Sophie's
off your
choice.
List.
Why did
you
kick him off?
The ghost of Hans.
The Nazis and Sophie's choice.
So I had to take someone off because, and really it came down to I couldn't find good Hans Gruber's clips on YouTube to splice in. You get behind the scenes.
You know,
folks.
In Hogan's Heroes, the Nazis are kind of fun. Like,
yeah,
right?
That's true.
Kirk
Clink.
Yeah.
It's kind of fun. Okay.
I don't know if that's a movie, but okay.
No, did they actually turn? They didn't make Hogan.
Might have made a movie out of that.
Made a movie
sure.
about the guy that played Hogan.
Yes.
Because he was a. Freak. Right? I had a lot of problems.
Okay, Samantha, who are your favorite villains?
Well, I wasn't going to say Beetlejuice, but I love that movie. Winona Ryder is like life inspiration.
Yeah.
I love her. So her outfits, the goth thing, it's my favorite.
She was a great teen.
Oh my gosh.
Character. Yeah.
So, awesome movie. Because he's like, you know, silly but creepy. I love that combination.
Yeah.
Love that combo. But I went for the nostalgia factor for this. So one of my favorite movies as a child was the 1996 version of Matilda.
Oh
that's a good one.
I don't know. I was obsessed because she has magical powers and I wanted to be her. But the headmistress of the school is like the scariest lady ever.
Not
her name
parents.
Is Trunchbull.
Mm-hmm.
And she like just controls the school, and she scares the children and locks them up in this, like, thing in her office. And then at the end, though, it's a happy ending because Matilda uses her powers to, like, throw down the evil headmistress. And
I think
really
that's a key to every good villain. They have to be bad enough to where there's a good payoff for the hero. I don't think the hero can be as powerful without
like
a good
Luke's
villain.
Father.
Like Luke's father. Which is
Wait, don't say who it is.
Exactly.
Don't have sense. We'll give it away.
So to go back to Winona Ryder, I just thought a great villain is Christian Slater and Heathers.
Oh, yes. Oh,
so,
my God.
Oh,
Heathers.
Yeah.
Heathers is good.
Mm-hmm.
That's a good one.
I just watched that recently.
Isn't that a great movie?
Yeah. Watched the end. But I guess they're all kind of villains in a way, though.
Yeah.
The group of mean girls.
The Heathers.
The
Heathers.
I was thinking the Heathers
are
the bad, but he's also bad.
Main Heather, who dies. she's kind of horrible. But then, yeah, he is just manipulative and evil.
Christian, he kind of had a resurgence now. Have you guys seen Mr. Robot?
Mm-hmm.
And
no,
he kind of almost plays a pseudo villain for that too. So
And Winona Ryder just had her Stranger Things.
Oh, that's right.
She's in that. As the mom.
You mentioned Uma Thurman. It reminded me that basically Kill Bill has got like a great rogues gallery of villains.
Yeah.
Kill Bill and Kill Bill Part 2. So pretty much everyone in that is a good villain.
Yeah.
You know,
I was thinking about Tarantino movies when you brought this up, because I was like, violence, lots of blood, horrible things, but I couldn't narrow it down.
Yeah, it's
they're all
bad,
because
right?
they're all kind of like
they're
anti-heroes.
What's it called? Pulp
Fiction.
Who's good?
Yeah.
Maybe Bruce Willis, but he's
his girlfriend.
But he did something, right? He's old.
He works for one of the gangsters.
He was
supposed
to fix
the
fight,
but
then
he
didn't. So he
didn't. Right.
He probably had done it before. I mean, he's probably not like a saint or anything.
Right.
He decides at that moment he's done.
Well, it's kind of like who's more vile. It's kind of like the Ving Rhames character isn't great, but then
the
whole
he's more likable than the rest.
Well, especially after what happens.
Yeah.
Yes, that was bad.
The camp.
The camp. Oh, that's good. So, here's a funny story.
That
so,
really scared me, too.
Okay,
I was like, what is going on?
So,
I don't understand. That was before I worked at Yahoo. I had a whole education on all of that stuff.
Oh,
so,
my. So, I wasn't 17 yet. And that was when we tried to get in.
Was it NC-17?
No, no, it was rated R, but they
R.
wouldn't let me in. To get
our
buddies, because I think we were 15 or 16. And,
but you weren't 17 yet.
So we go to the movies, we're like, we want to see Pulp Fiction. They're like, are you kidding? You guys can't come in. So I'm pretty sure we paid to see Forrest Gump and then snuck in. And that whole scene, I was like, I was looking at my buddy and I'm like, maybe we should have seen Forrest Gump. This is awful. But I just remember the Christopher Walken scene just cracked me up in the theater.
He's
like,
really good.
The gold watch. And,
And then we said Kaiser Sose.
Kaiser Sose is kind of the ultimate, but you really don't know.
The ultimate villain, but what's the name of the movie?
Ultimate gotcha movie.
Twist.
The
like
Usual
twist,
Suspects.
The Usual Suspects, thank you.
Yes.
Beetle. Juice.
Okay, so we have Enrica, and we're in the wind tunnel, so if you hear echo, that's why. Okay, Enrica, what are your favorite movie villains?
So the first one is from childhood, and obviously everybody loves the movie The Princess Bride.
Yes.
But my favorite character was Prince Humperdinck. I thought he was super cute, and he was a prince. And he was also kind of badass. Like, he was really good at sword fighting and riding horses, and he was kind of an asshole and a bad guy, and like clearly a villain. But he was like, Iocane powder, I bet my life on it. Like, he knew all the shit, and he was a hardcore dude. And he was also the worst, and, like, caused all the trouble in the world.
Yeah.
So, for that reason, I was like, this is a good villain. Because not only is he, like, a problem, but he's also, like, kind of a cool dude.
Right.
Like, he's not a prince just by resting on his laurels.
Mm-hmm.
Like, he learned how to sword fight.
Yes.
He learned how to identify poisonous substances, which apparently you can do when you're a prince.
Mm-hmm.
And he was just trying to do his duty and, like, get a bride that was a good bride. But
hence the title.
He was also an asshole and caused all the trouble.
That is a great movie, though. That is really good. And then I thought for sure you're going to say something from Free Willy. So
there's no villains in Free Willy, are there?
There's nothing in the ocean that attacks. So I don't know.
My first one was, I was going to say, but then I can still say it probably, right?
Of course. This is your podcast.
My other favorite villain is from very recent years, and that's Benedict Cumberbatch's Khan in the Star Trek movies.
Oh, okay. Yeah, yeah.
Because, one, Benedict Cumberbatch is so good,
yes.
And that voice, like, so convincingly evil.
Mm-hmm.
And also just the character of Khan. It was in Star Trek The Next Generation,
yes.
And then again in the movies, resurrected in the form of Benedict Cumberbatch. And it was just, like, so good because he's kind of super smart as a villain and kind of freaky.
You've seen the original.
Yeah.
Con with,
what was the actor's name? I was just talking about this with Akira.
Ricardo Montalban.
Yes!
Treasure Island.
I was just talking about that with Akira. And he was like, if you liked this Con,
you should
see the original Con. I was like, nobody can be better than Benedict.
One of the episodes we talk about, I think it's David Gelber talks about, because he saw Star Trek VI as his first movie.
Another
movie we talk about. Wrath of Khan. So, yes, great mullet, great chest plate suit.
Yeah,
right. So,
totally.
Yeah.
I just love Benedict Cumberbatch when he does evil things.
Yeah.
Because it makes you feel genuinely terrified. You're like, this is a scary person.
Well, I think the villains actually are the best characters. They're the heavies. That's, I think, what actors want to play.
And my least favorite villain, fucking, excuse my language, sorry, not appropriate. Fucking the same from Batman with the Bane or whatever.
Oh yeah, yeah. That way you can't understand anything he's
not
saying.
Even that, he's just not scary.
Yeah.
Like, nothing kills my buzz more than when I'm seeing a movie and, like, genuinely not afraid of the consequences
of that guy.
Of the bad thing happening, right? Because there's a conflict at the center of every story. And, like, if the bad guy is not scaring me, I'm just like, send me home.
Saying face, respirator face does nothing for you.
No, so he looked scary enough. It was just, he wasn't like an intimidating character to me. I don't know what it was.
Okay.
I don't know.
I think Batman felt differently, but yeah.
Well, he was supposed to feel that way for the cameras. He was doing it for the views.
Got it. Okay, so those are the two, or did you have the...
I think that's it.
Okay.
That was the two.
Sorry, Bane. You suck.
Sorry, Bane. I hate you, but Khan forever. And also Prince Humperdinck. Call me.
It's odd. But when I hired Vizzini to have her murdered on our engagement day, I thought that was clever. But it's going to be so much more moving when I strangle her on our wedding night. Once Gilda is blamed, the nation will be truly outraged. They'll demand we go to war. Now, where is that secret knot? Impossible to find. Ah. Are you coming down into the pit? Wesley's got his strength back. I'm starting him on the machine tonight.
Tyrone, you know how much I love watching you work. But I've got my country's 500th anniversary to plan, my wedding to arrange, my wife to murder, and Gilda to frame for it. I'm swamped.
All right, we're here with Stephanie, who is always great on the podcast. And so this time we're going to go through your favorite villains in movies. So this is your podcast. Go to town.
All right. Hey, everybody. So I made a list because I was thinking about it. Because, you know, this is tough. There are a lot of great villains, right? You've got the Emperor, of course, in the Star Wars series, but that's too easy. You've got Voldemort. You've got Khan in Star Trek. Because Khan was serious. Remember Ricardo Montalban as Khan?
We just talked about
him. Oh, my gosh. Oh, wow. The stepmother in Cinderella. That was a great villain. Steph in Pretty in Pink. He was really evil.
Yes.
But I have to say, I think my greatest villain of all time, and I know this is cheesy, but it's got to be the Wicked Witch of the West from Wizard of Oz.
That's a great one.
I saw the Wizard of Oz at least 100 times as a kid. My grandfather had a VCR, and he was the only one in the family with a VCR. Because if you've been paying attention, I grew up really poor. And we had two cassettes. We had a recorded version of Wizard of Oz, because remember it showed every year.
Oh, yeah, on Thanksgiving.
Yeah, on Thanksgiving. Mm-hmm. You could always see it every year. So he recorded it one year. And then I also had a recording of Mary Poppins.
Mm-hmm.
So we go to visit my grandparents, small apartment, boring. We'd watch Mary Poppins or we'd watch The Wizard of Oz.
Yeah.
And so we watched Wizard of Oz over and over and over again. And I swear, for at least 50 viewings, mm-hmm. that witch was the scariest thing there was.
She was perfectly casted in that
role.
Oh,
yeah. My gosh. That scene where the hourglass mm-hmm. is running out of time, and the music, and they're trying with the axe to open the door, mm-hmm. and they get her out, and then there the witch is, and she's up above, and she does that cackle. Oh, to this day.
You can't watch her in another movie.
No.
I mean, that is her role.
And her career was ruined as
pretty
a result.
Much, yeah.
So they couldn't cast her in anything else. Because even with all that makeup, it didn't matter. Her nose, actress's nose was so pronounced. And
yes.
Even though they did some prosthetic, it was a dead giveaway. Poor, she was so good at it.
I know.
She couldn't work again.
That's right.
I.
That is going to be another podcast. Like, actors who can never get out of that one role.
Oh yeah, like Skywalker.
Exactly.
Mark Hamill, right?
He can't
right?
do anything else.
Like I can't, and maybe he shouldn't. He needs to go see somebody about the visage or however you say
that. He was in Corvette Summer. Thank you, Stu. But yeah, it did not hold up well. So.
Yeah, no, I since then. And the other thing that's really cool about The Wicked Witch, I think, is after you read the book Wicked,
yeah.
and then you know, or you see the musical, you all know about Wicked.
Mm-hmm.
When you watch The Wizard of Oz now as a grown-up, there's a layer now. I'm so grateful to Gregory Maguire. I think that was the author.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry if it isn't. even now, like now she has even more depth.
Yeah.
This idea of questioning why she was as upset as she was.
Sure.
Why those two sisters were terrorizing those poor munchkins.
Mm-hmm.
What had happened. And this idea that maybe she could have actually been intending some good.
Mm-hmm.
There's just a whole other layer to her and she's far more complex. And I still love it. And it's funny, I have a 10-year-old daughter. And to this day, you know, we watch Wizard of Oz once a year. And to this day, you know, nobody scares her like the Wicked Witch of the West.
That's amazing. So Enrique, that was the one movie that scared her the most.
Yeah.
Because of, oh, no, it was Samantha, because of the monkeys.
Oh.
So yeah, yes.
So it's on the most scary and it's on the best villains.
Yeah. Well, my mom, that was her first movie that she saw in a theater.
Oh.
And she, in high school, that's who she played. She played the Wicked Witch.
Oh,
and
my
so
gosh.
She absolutely loved that role.
So I played Eva Meany in The Wiz
there
in junior high school.
There you go.
I could do the voice and everything.
Well, the villains are always the most fun to play.
Yeah.
They're the heaviest. So,
yeah.
All right. Thank you, Steph.
Thanks, Brian.
I'll get you, my pretty, and your little dog, too.
Okay, so we're here with David, and David's a deaf and veteran of the podcast, so we're happy to have you back on.
Hello.
All right, so we're going to do your favorite villains that are not superhero villains, because eventually, I'm sure we'll do a show. And you can do that one, because you definitely are... would school me on villain superhero knowledge. So, what do you got?
So, I thought we were going to do, like, movie monsters because it was Halloween and stuff.
Sure.
So, I was thinking more in line of, like, horror genre and stuff. So, I was thinking, like, really cool just movie monsters in general. Classic being Freddy is, like... Because I like, especially when it comes to scary movie villains... just a structure of, like, they're so menacing, but they always have, like, that one thing that you're like, oh, just avoid that, and, you know, you can just avoid the bad monster forever. And Freddy has such an awesome heel of, if you just don't fall asleep, then... So
you're good.
I always thought that was really cool.
Well, you can go through that. So we can run the gamut with you, because you're a total movie buff, so this is good. Okay, so if we're just going to go in that one. What are your favorite... horror villains.
Like I was saying, I like the structure.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's really cool with Freddy, no sleep thing. Recently, the Diana, the monster in Lights Out.
Oh, yeah.
It's really cool because it's that same, just that simple, you know, law of you don't do this and you'll avoid the thing forever. And then the monster from It Follows.
I haven't seen that one.
Same thing where if you don't have premarital, you know, sex with a stranger, then you won't get a STD ghost following you. Of course, the thing with having like the simple kind of rule to follow, the longer a series goes, like with Freddy, of course, there's like the blending of, well, now he's powerful enough to cross out from the dream world, blah, blah, blah. So there always kind of gets to be that point. And then kind of why Lights Out, It Follows, movies like that are not quite so perfect is because the monster does break its own rules a lot of the time. So just, you know, to aid the scary jumpness and that kind of thing. But
that's a great part of it, the original kind of the Friday the 13th. It's always premarital sex. It's like if that's the the rule to learn that if you do that, you're going to get axed or something like that. Yeah. So what is your favorite Nightmare on Elm Street classic? Like of the
Dream Warriors.
I think we talked about
Dream
this.
Warriors
we're talking
is
and,
so good.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean the first one's the only one that actually stands out as an actual legit scary movie.
Right. Johnny Depp, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. It eventually progressed and devolved into kind of camp and all that. But before it got to that point, the first one was actually had something to say. It was really creepy. The creature design of Freddy himself was like, if you see that as a kid, you're like, oh my gosh, like that's so, he just looks ugly. He looks gross. And he's like slimy. Mm-hmm. Whereas somebody like Michael Myers, it's just like, well, it's just a big dude in a mask.
Yeah.
Like, okay. Or like Jason, like, yeah, under the mask, he's really ugly, but like, he's just another big dirty looking dude in a mask. Like, but yeah, Freddy was like, oh, like, yeah, just as a character, I think, like as a monster, he works really well.
Well, I think especially back in the day, nobody, I think, predicted that these were ever going to go past that one film. So that's why they kind of hold up.
Yeah.
And then eventually they realized, okay, that one did really well. We're going to have to milk this.
Yeah.
And now when they create horror films, I think they're almost going for the franchise.
Yeah. Well, I think Friday the 13th was the one where they really were just like, this is just going to be a franchise.
Yeah.
And they just like barreled along like year after year.
Yeah.
Kind of like how recently with Saw, with like every Halloween, you're going to get another one. Friday the 13th, I think, was probably the first of like the schlocky slashers that was just like, you're going to get this every year.
Yeah.
And like, yeah, the return business will probably not be as strong.
In the 80s, I want to say like every single year of that decade, there was a Friday the 13th movie.
Yeah, I think, for the most part, throughout the entire 80s, they might have skipped like a year when they got like really bad. They're like, all right, let's take our time. But for the most part, you got either a Freddy, a Jason, a Michael Myers, like every year. I think the other ones, like Hellraiser was late 80s, I want to say. And then those ones were more spread out. Same with like Leprechaun going like straight to DVD and stuff,
which was Terry's Chris's first movie in theater. Leprechaun,
the first Leprechaun, was kind of scary.
And you do remember whose debut acting. Amazing.
Everybody's favorite friend. As far as creature design goes, the Leprechaun kind of had the same, not aesthetic, but kind of like as Freddy, of like this gross, ugly, like slimy looking, like the prosthetics and like, the makeup and everything. Like, he, aside from the fact that he was like a little miniature, you know, guy coming after you, he was still kind of menacing.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's kind of like why something like Child's Play was never really
that's what I was gonna say.
Scary, because you're like, well, it's a little doll, I can just kick it away and I'll be fine.
So you didn't like Child's Play at all? Or the...
I don't know if I brought this up before, but when I was a kid, I loved horror movies, but they would always freak me out, even though I would always seek them out.
Yeah.
For whatever reason, Child's Play never really got under my skin.
Hmm.
It never really freaked me out. Because, even like the first Leprechaun I saw when I was a kid, that was not terrifying, but like just thinking of the Leprechaun itself was like, ooh, creepy. Same thing with Freddy, like, oh, like just something visually like that, just
Freddy always seemed to be the most scary, at least to me, because it was always in your dreams. Like, it just seemed
I mean, by the time Freddy came out was maybe not like early, well,
mid, it was 84,
early ish so but it was kind of like when Halloween and Friday the 13th, like, they started to just kind of sputter out, because they Friday the 13th, Friday was just like rushing them too much.
Yeah.
And just
there was
really
no supernatural.
Yeah.
To it. Yeah.
And Michael Myers, they were trying to do Halloween was going to be a brand name, not necessarily you come to these movies to see Michael Myers kill teenagers.
Right.
And that's where Halloween 3, Season of the Witch, was like, there's no Michael Myers.
Yeah.
It was its own like anthology thing, and they were going to anthologize it. And then it did horribly. Now, of course, everyone was like, that was a really cool idea, and that's a really, really good movie. But at the time, everyone was like, they were conditioned.
Yeah.
And the argument being, had they started with the anthology idea right from the get-go of Halloween 1, just Michael Myers, Halloween 2 being the Season of the Witch kind of thing, then you wouldn't have conditioned everybody because, you know, they did 2, so that was enough to be like...
Did John Carpenter do the third one?
I think he just was an EP on it.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that's, that might have been the reason he might not have let that happen.
Well, I think 2, bringing back Michael Myers, was...
Yeah.
A studio thing of
right.
like, holy crap, that made so much money and it cost nothing.
Mm-hmm.
Let's just bang out another one of these.
Right.
And and then they're like, oh, let's try something else.
Yeah. Okay, so non-horror movie, what's your favorite villains for non-horror movies?
I think my favorite surprise villain.
Yeah.
I'm gonna say Daniel Plainview.
Okay.
From There Will Be Blood.
Oh yeah, someone actually already said that one.
Yeah.
That's a good one.
Because he's the main character. He's technically the protagonist.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I would consider him more an antagonist just because
from
the perspective of everybody else in that world, he is a liar. He's a cheat. He's an awful, awful person.
Yeah.
But just, you know, from our audience perspective, he's our view into the world.
Yeah.
But everybody else in his world is like... distance himself from him, and he was just an awful person.
It's a gritty character. I mean, he pulls that off. Well, has Daniel Day-Lewis been in anything lately? Like,
I think the last thing he did might have been Lincoln.
Oh, yeah.
Because he did Lincoln after that.
Yeah. It goes from that to Lincoln.
Yeah.
That shows you how good of an actor is. I mean,
But Lincoln was like 2011, maybe, so it's been a while. I don't know if he's... Yeah, I don't know if he's done anything.
I was trying to remember, because Celine picked him. Was he bad in Last of the Mohicans? Or was he kind of like... I can't
remember.
That
was kind of the issue of, like, the white guy saves the day,
wasn't it? Yeah.
So,
I think he was good.
I think so.
But it's been a while. All I remember is the art scene.
Yeah.
Being in the theater for that one.
I think technically he was the hero of the movie.
Okay.
Kind of like how technically Tom Cruise was the hero of The Last Samurai,
though
he wasn't a samurai.
A good point. Let's go out on a good note. Tom Cruise as The Last
Tom
Samurai.
Tom will always be my samurai.
Yes. Are you going to go see Jack Reacher?
I really liked the first one.
Yeah, I
did
too.
And
the books are good.
Yeah, but apparently the new one is not so hot.
Right. So it comes out this week?
I think so.
Okay.
So,
yeah.
But, I thought the first one was pretty cool. So
I liked it.
Yeah. Maybe not
pay
full
price. I'm
actually
surprised they made a second one because the first one did okay, but it wasn't like a blockbuster.
Yeah, it didn't make a lot of money. But the people behind it, Tom and Chris McQuarrie, I think is his name, he ended up... It all is under the Paramount umbrella.
Uh-huh.
And so after that, they pulled Chris into Mission Impossible 5, and that being such a hit, they're like, oh, well, you know, you and Tom, you have a thing, so let's do another one of those Jack Reachers. So,
and they're going to do another Mission Impossible, it sounds like.
Yeah, they're doing 6.
They keep getting good. Like, I'm impressed with how good they've been.
Speaking of villains,
Philip
Seymour Hoffman in Mission Impossible 3,
yes,
really good villain.
Yes.
Just like that menacing, really just...
Yeah, he's definitely missed. Philip Seymour Hoffman was good in everything, pretty much he did. Funny story about Jack Reacher. So I'm in the movie theater, and it might have been, I forgot what year it was, but it was definitely post the shooting in Colorado.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you remember the beginning of Jack Reacher, it's a sniper.
Yeah.
And so maybe, I want to say 30 minutes into the movie, a guy walks in with a backpack. And I'm looking at him like I can't focus on the movie because I keep waiting for him to do something.
To pull something
and it shouldn't be like that. But
I
was ready. I was ready. If he was going to do it, I knew where to grab.
I think Jack Reacher was 2012.
Yeah.
So that would have been Dark Knight Rises was 2012 as well. So
I think it was right around that time. So everyone was high-edged, yeah. Can't bring backpacks into the theater.
I always feel weird bringing a backpack in.
Well, one, they don't want you to because you'll sneak in food, but that's a thing. All right, thanks, David.
Yep.
It's fair for you, kid. Sorry, kids. I don't believe in fairy tales.
Okay, so we're here with Celine, and this time, on this episode, we're going to go through your favorite villains, non-superheroes. So, you had a good one, but we're going to hold off until the next episode.
All right.
When we do actual superhero villains. So, who are your favorite villains in the movies?
Favorite villains? Well, I did a little research, so I feel very well prepared for this one. I just have to say, just preface what the ones I chose in general. I like villains who are complicated, like who have an interesting backstory, or they had something happen to them, or they change over time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like they become more villainous.
Sure.
And so,
because nobody starts
or
evil.
Or they're a villain or they're redeemed. In
sure.
End. Although with the ones I'm doing, I don't know if they're really redeemed. So I chose two, and the first was Benedict Cumberbatch in Star Trek Into Darkness. He's Khan.
Yeah.
And I thought, first of all, I thought he was the sexiest Khan that I've ever seen.
You didn't like Ricardo?
No, I was going to say he was a lot sexier than Ricardo Montalban.
But he had the nice mullet and the chess piece and everything. So.
He was good. I just like, because I had never seen him acting evil like that, you know, and I like it because he's one of those ones that he can act.
Yeah,
you know you can kind of see, he can be evil, but you can see the vulnerability. Like it's the same with what's his name in the last Star Trek. The hell is that actor's name? You know, Darth.
I know exactly what he looks like, but
the young guy.
Yes, I'm gonna have to go back in.
Sorry,
that's okay.
Yeah, he was good. You know, you could see like. You can see, with a good villain, you can see them struggling with the pull of, like, maybe possibly going to the light side, but the dark side has a greater pull on them.
You know what's funny is Enrique picked Benedict, too, for her. In the
same
role.
Movie?
Yeah.
Yeah, oh, he was so good. He's always good.
I just
watched The Imitation Game.
I can't find him, but I'll have to do some fun editing to get
someone will say him.
Sure.
Sure, yeah.
Okay, so definitely like Benedict.
And then the next one I chose is you're never sure if he's a villain or not till the very end of the film.
Mm-hmm.
He's very complex too, is Daniel Day-Lewis in There Will Be Blood.
Oh, yes, that's a great movie.
That movie was just like devastating. The end was so devastating.
Oh, yeah.
And he's like, you can't really tell, has he been like morally bankrupt the whole time,
mm-hmm.
or has life made him that way over time?
Right.
He's never like a nice guy.
No, he's always super complicated.
He's never a nice guy in that movie, but you don't see the end coming.
No.
So I thought that was pretty skillful.
That's a really good one. What was the last movie he was in? Like, I'm trying to remember.
God, that's. I can't remember.
That might have been
the last one I saw him in.
Yeah.
Yeah. So.
Was he good or bad in the last of the Mohicans? I can't even remember.
I don't know if I even saw that one.
He's intense in that one, too. So, yeah.
That one came out, like, in the early 90s or something?
Yeah. Early to mid, yeah.
I'm not sure I saw it. I don't think I did.
Okay. No, those are good. Those are really good. I'll come back at the end, and I'll tell you who Darth Vader was. Cool.
All right, cool.
Thank you, Celine.
Thanks, Brian.
I have a competition in me. I want no one else to succeed. I hate most people.
That part of me is gone. Working and not succeeding. All my failures has left me. I just don't care.
Well, if it's in me, it's in you. There are times when I look at people and I see nothing worth liking. I want to earn enough money I can get away from everyone.
What will you do about your boy?
I don't know. Maybe it'll change. Has your sound come back to you? I don't know. Maybe no one knows that. Doctor might not know that.
Where's his mother?
I don't want to talk about those things. I see the worst in people, Henry. I don't need to look past seeing them to get all I need. I've built up my hatreds over the years, little by little. Having you here gives me a second breath, and I can't keep doing this on my own. With these, people.
All right, so we're here with Diane, who is returning because she did favorite horror films the last time. So this time she's going to name her favorite movie villains. All right, so what do you have?
Well, my favorite movie villain is the Borg Queen.
Okay.
And just the Borg race in general. Mm-hmm. She was in Star Trek 8, First Contact.
Okay.
So the crew of the Enterprise... They go back in time to stop the Borg from infiltrating Earth and just destroying humanity.
Right.
Causing.
So were you? You obviously got into Star Trek in the beginning with the TV shows and everything. So
yes.
Which version of Star Trek do you enjoy the most?
That would have to be the Next Generation.
Okay.
Yeah.
So did you ever watch the original version with the?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, I did. I tried to watch as many episodes as I could, but there's a few I think I've missed.
Right.
But,
right.
Yeah.
So as for the movies, what is your favorite era of the movies?
Oh well, you know, I really liked all of them.
Mm-hmm.
I like the reboot,
okay.
But they're it's a little bit strange.
Sure.
Yeah. I mean.
Do you? So this is funny. So two people have picked Benedict Cumberbatch for their favorite villain so far. So that's
okay.
Fine. We're kind of doing a Star Trek theme in this
one.
So that's good. Those are good ones. Okay. So any non Star Trek villains from movies that are some of your favorites?
Oh yeah. There's a Lo Pan from.
Mm-hmm.
Oh gosh, what is that movie called? This is embarrassing because my cousin's actually in this movie.
Oh no way!
Yeah, I've never met the guy, but he
mm-hmm.
He's a distant relative.
Okay.
But I used to live nearby his mom.
Oh cool.
In Stockton.
Nice.
California. Yeah, and Big Trouble in Little China.
Oh yeah. Yes, that's a great movie. That's a fun
movie.
That's a good one. Any other ones that you can think of?
I don't know, just off the top of my head,
mm-hmm.
maybe Blofeld from the James Bond series.
That's a good one, too.
Yeah.
So, okay, let's get into James Bond then. So, what's your favorite era of James Bond?
I guess I really like the current ones.
Okay.
With Daniel Craig.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They're more dark than they really get kind of into his backstory.
Yeah, interesting, yeah.
So, it's funny. So, I really liked, obviously, I think I like three of the four the best. It was the second one. What was that one? It's Casino Royale, then whatever the one was right after that.
I think that was Quantum of Solace.
For whatever reason, I couldn't get into that one. I don't know why. But I loved Skyfall, and I liked the last one, too. It was good. But I agree. So if you had to choose between Roger Moore, Sean Connery, and Pierce Brosnan, who are you going with?
Sean Connery.
Okay, that seems pretty standard. So of the Connery era, who were your favorite villains for those?
Let's see here. Favorite villains. I picked Blofeld, but tell you the truth, I don't really remember him too well. He just popped up in my head because he's the amongst most fans, he's probably
the
most popular.
I guess Goldfinger comes up a lot, obviously. Those are all
good.
Yeah. The guy throws his hat that can basically.
Oh, right.
Odd Job.
Yeah.
Yes, he's always fun. And then
cool.
Jaws.
He was
the Roger Moore era.
Yeah.
Because then he ends up turning good in one of them. I don't know if it was Moonraker or one of them where he goes from being bad to good. So those are always good ones.
Yeah.
Yes. So.
Yeah.
Awesome. Well, thank you, Diana. If you think of any more, let me know. And at the end, I'm piling all the
villains that people forget once they leave the studio here.
Yeah,
we'll do. So, cool. Right. Thanks, Dan.
Thank you.
Resistance is futile.
Okay, so we're here with Danielle. And Danielle is, of course, laughing because this is what she does. Okay, so we're going to go through your favorite movie villains that are not superheroes.
Okay. Cannot be TV series, right?
Yeah, if you're really nice, maybe we'll let you have in one. But for now, can you give me your top movie villains?
But you need to help me because I don't know how to say in English the names.
Okay.
So my number one that I think is the best is Annie Wilkes from Misery.
Oh, yeah.
Yes. So she's...
That's, God, what's her name? Bates, Kathy Bates.
Yes, I have it.
So that one you have. Yeah.
Yes. Okay. So that's my favorite.
Have you read the book, Misery?
No.
Stephen King. That's Stephen
I love
King.
Stephen King.
So what about her character does that makes it one of your favorites?
I don't know. She's scary. When the camera shows her face when she's like breaking the feet of the guy with the...
That's the famous scene.
Yes.
James Caan, by the way.
Yes. You can see in her face like...
She's enjoying
you
it.
You buy it like, wow, she's a very good actress.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. So this is nothing you've done before, I hope.
Let me think.
Okay.
No.
Okay, good. Okay, so Kathy Bates
yes.
is one of your top ones. What is your next one?
So my next one is John Doe from Seven, Kevin Space.
Oh, yeah.
Yes. So he is amazing. I mean, it's Kevin Space. Everything he does, it's amazing. I love him. But on that movie, the final scene when he says...
What's in the box?
No, I don't even... It's not even the box scene. It's like... When he wraps up, you know, all the seven scenes, he says, I don't know what the name is in English, but he says, like...
The seven deadly sins.
Yes, no, but wait, I have the name.
she has notes, folks.
The envy, right,
yes,
with him.
Yes.
And then because
he's envious
he was
of that
envy
guy's
and
life.
He killed, the other one would be the wrath. I don't know.
I don't know. Do you know the seven deadly sins?
I know vanity. I know the eating one.
Gluttony?
It's wrath. Envy.
Was it lust? Is lust one of them?
Lust, yes.
Yeah.
And that's it.
Okay.
I don't know
if that was six, but or seven. So
no, it was not.
No, but if you heard the last episode... One of my worst date movies was actually Seven because it was the first date. It's a great movie, but
it's
tough date.
It's a great movie, and the Kevin Space, like, I don't like Brad Pitt, I like in movies. I don't think he's a good actor.
So do you like Gwyneth Paltrow?
Yes.
So you were upset that her head was in a box?
I could see that coming. Of course that
you saw it coming.
Of course.
I see.
Of course. Something
first saw
had to do.
I didn't get it.
Really?
Well,
no.
I was only 16, 17.
She was too vulnerable. I knew that was coming.
Yeah.
Not the head, but I knew something would happen to her.
Sure.
For sure.
Like a finger.
I don't know which part of the body, but.
Okay, so that was number two. These are all great ones. Totally unexpected. Nobody has said these yet.
Really?
What is your number three?
So my number three is John Milton from. The Devil's Advocate.
So Al Pacino?
Al Pacino.
That's
a
good one.
He is amazing, that movie. Of course, it's Al Pacino. He's
good in everything.
He's always amazing. But that one with
Keanu Reeves, unfortunately, Keanu's in it, yes.
Yeah, no, come on. I love Keanu Reeves.
Are you serious?
I'm going to watch everything he works on.
You need to talk to David Gelber.
Love him. Love.
And Charlize Theron was
yes,
one of her first
she's gorgeous. I love her too, but I love Keanu Reeves the most.
Really?
But Al Pacino, But
have
Al
you seen
Pacino,
the movie Point Break?
I don't know, maybe.
You should, if you like Keanu Reeves.
Yes.
And Patrick Swayze's in it.
Yeah, I don't like Patrick's.
What the hell?
Okay, anyway.
So,
this is
my show.
Al Pacino
is
the best. And his final... It's always like the final scenes that take me... You know, it holds me. like from Misery was on the on that scene on the legs.
Sure.
For the seven was the last sentence that he
said before
like,
he got shot.
And for him, for Al Pacino, it was when he says that vanity is his favorite sin.
Mm-hmm.
That's genius. That's you can see in his face. It was great. I love it.
Those are great. Those are three. Do you have any more?
Yes,
those?
I do. I have one
she
more.
She has a scroll. It's like the Ten Commandments. So.
I have one more,
okay.
And this is a classic. Everybody
okay.
thinks about him. It is Buffalo Bill from The Silence of the Lambs.
So you didn't pick Hannibal Lecter.
No, he's not a villain on that movie. He's a villain on Hannibal, on the sequel.
Okay.
But not on that.
See, my number 9, I believe, was Hannibal. Or
yeah.
Number 5, yeah.
No, he's great, of course. He hypnotizes with the eye.
Yes.
But Buffalo Bill, you know, is king, new woman, and that is really creepy what he does, and the scenes with him, and the hole that he has the woman, that just
he puts the lotion in the basket.
It's just everything, when the lights goes off with Clarice in his house, and that you can see his breathing, that's scary, so.
And he's wearing the mask.
Exactly, so yes. He is the villain in that movie, I don't think. Hannibal is the villain. I actually like Hannibal in the movie.
Well, actually, that's the tricky part, because Hannibal's a bad guy.
He is.
He's a killer, but you need him to catch the even worse guy.
Yes. Yes. He has the habit of eating people. So, but the other one is the worst. I think it's the worst.
Yes.
So.
And Hannibal killed the warden. Did he kill the warden that was treating him bad?
I don't know.
I'm trying to remember.
I saw that movie 7 times.
Wow.
In Brazil.
And you're well adjusted. Good job.
I am. I saw that movie 7 times. Yes.
Wow. Did you see yourself as Clarice or something?
No. I love Anthony Hopkins in that movie.
He's brilliant.
And every time I want to read him,
mm-hmm.
I don't like the sequels that much.
No, they don't hold up as well.
But him. Yes, I like the body, like the way that he talks, and even when he's like all, how do you say on the?
He's got the straitjacket.
Yes.
Yeah.
He's still amazing.
I wonder if the sequel would have been better if Jodie Foster had been instead of Julianne Moore. Even though Julianne Moore wasn't bad, but
yeah, but Jodie Foster
is
way better.
Amazing. Yeah.
Yes, and we already. Love Clarice from the first one,
right.
So it was hard to adapt.
It's always hard to have basically not even it's not his her sister or anything. Basically, it's
yes.
supposed to be Clarice again, and
yes.
that's hard. Do you have any more? Because you
no,
have,
that's
it.
The movies.
Well, thank you so much. That's a great list.
Thank
you can
you.
Be back on the show anytime.
Oh, thank you.
You're welcome. Just don't break my legs or anything.
It rubs the lotion on its skin. It does this whenever it's told.
Mister, my family will pay cash. Whatever ransom you're asking for, they'll pay it.
It rubs the lotion on its skin or else it gets the hose again. Now it places the lotion in the basket. Put the fucking lotion in the basket!
All right, so we're here with Chris, who was wonderful on the first two episodes. She took a break from the third.
Uh-huh.
Which was the worst date movies, and now she's back
right.
for favorite movie villains. So, okay, Chris, what is your favorite movie villain?
So, this is probably not, you know, the typical villain that you would think of. But
this is what we like.
Yeah, so it's the Julia Roberts character from My Best Friend's Wedding.
Okay, so why does this stick out for you the most?
I think she just... So she's both the antagonist and protagonist.
Right.
You know? She tries to... ruin her best friend's wedding
mm-hmm.
because she had feelings for him that, you know, were never expressed
mm-hmm.
or, you know, she never really bothered to pay attention to them until, you know, he was already spoken for, right? So the thing I like about her is that I think she just shows something that's real. Like, we can both be antagonists and
mm-hmm.
protagonists in
right.
our story, so we can't be straightforward good all the time, and there's something in us that's selfish also.
Sure.
And that's what she showed and she acted upon, and she it came from a very good place, I think. Like, she wanted to follow her heart. But
so you were rooting for her?
No, guess I was. Like, it's the classic, like, the best friends have to be together in the end.
Right.
And then, you
right
know,
or wrong?
Yeah, right or wrong.
Okay, and, so did you, were you a Julia Roberts fan before?
I was not. I mean,
really?
I wasn't really a big fan of her, but
okay.
Since it's also kind of a musical.
Yeah. Well, speaking of musicals, so you're going to sing the theme song for us now, aren't you?
I will sing the...
Okay.
I will sing the song that her other friend sang.
Okay, which was played by who?
Rupert Everett.
Okay, so okay, we're going to have a first on this show. Yeah. Go ahead, Chris. Nobody's watching you.
The moment I wake up, before I put on my makeup, I say a little prayer for you, and that's it.
That's amazing. So this is going to be our intro and outro every single show. Thank you, Chris.
Somebody has to sing.
Somebody has to sing. I think you and Enrica should do a duet. I think that would be good. She sang the theme to Free Willy.
Good. Don't put our episodes or our, you know,
recordings together.
Space
them out?
Yes,
okay.
So that people can recover from from my bad singing.
No, that was very good singing, and we will do karaoke at some point.
Yes.
And then we'll report on that as well.
All right.
All right. Thank you so much, Chris.
Thank you. The moment I wake up, before I put on my makeup, I say a little prayer for you, and that's it.
All right, we finally got Gwendolyn on the show. She's a longtime listener, first-time caller, but she's not really calling. Anyway, we're here with Gwendolyn. We're also here with Danielle, who's going to do voices and translate to Portuguese if she so is so inclined, but we'll see. Mostly she'll probably just laugh in the background. All right, so Gwendolyn, who are your favorite movie villains?
Well, I think, first of all, to talk about villains, you have to talk about the definition of villains.
Okay, so we're going to get really technical here, and you're the first
yes.
to actually have some research.
Right.
So I'd love to hear, what is your definition of a villain?
Well, this isn't my own definition, but this is the American Film Institute.
Highly respected, yes.
Highly respected, also known as AFI.
Yes.
And they define a villain as a character whose wickedness of mind, selfishness of character, and will to power are sometimes masked by beauty and nobility, while others may rage unmasked. They can be horribly evil or grandiosely funny, but are ultimately tragic.
Oh, wow.
And they have a certain legacy and a cultural impact on the film business
mm-hmm.
or film industry. And so when I think about that definition, the person that comes to mind is Jack Torrance of The Shining, played by Jack Nicholson.
Mm-hmm.
And as you know, Jack Nicholson, he also played another villain, which was the Joker.
That's right.
So he is like the ultimate villain.
He is the ultimate villain. And again, we're going to do another podcast strictly for superhero villains. So he could be
nice.
On that too. Did you want to translate in Portuguese? Never mind. Keep going.
He was a superhero though?
Well, he was the Joker, so
oh,
it was in a superhero movie,
okay.
So yes.
Okay. So maybe I should explain first the film, The Shining. Have you seen The Shining?
Absolutely.
Okay.
And I'm sure Danielle has too. Yeah.
So this film was released in 1980, and I saw parts of it as a child. But when I saw the full film as an adult, it was just still, you know, had this impact on me. It was just really riveting.
Mm-hmm.
And so basically the plot is that Jack Nicholson, his character, ends up being a winter caretaker for a hotel. And it's this isolated hotel in Colorado. And he's hoping to spend the time writing because he has writer's block. But he brings his family, which is his wife, played by Shelley Duvall. Remember Shelley Duvall?
Of course. I remember on a bunch of PBS stuff.
And olive oil.
And olive oil, that's right. And then the horrible movie rendition of Popeye.
Ah, right.
Yes.
And
who played Popeye?
Robin Williams.
Very good.
No idea.
Oh, thanks a lot. Okay.
So the son has these psychotic premonitions, and he sees these visions in the hotel. And so they're isolated up there during the winter, and Jack Nicholson's character transforms into this, what you would say, a villain, because he becomes really psychotic, and he ends up having these thoughts about killing his family. I think that the reason why Jack Nicholson, or Jack Torrance, is such a great villain is because he's so believable.
Mm-hmm.
And also his facial expressions, just amazing, because you just see him and he just looks so evil. And I come to a conclusion, I think I know what it is, and it's his eyebrows. It's those high arching eyebrows,
yes.
Which, you know, in the Joker, it was the same.
That's right.
Thing, so.
I think those were painted on, but, you know.
That's they're not real?
I don't know. But this is why I pluck my eyebrows, so just so you know.
Well, you do?
I do.
Wow, did you know that, Danielle?
She's on her phone. What is it? I mean, horrible.
Why do you wax your eyebrows?
I guess everything's coming out now. So, yes. So, because Jesus.
I've heard.
Yeah.
Oh.
There are some that do. Yes.
Okay.
I didn't know you did.
No, back to your phone. Okay, Gwen. So, can you recover from that? Yeah.
So, one of the turning points in the movie is when Jack's wife sees exactly what Jack Nicholson is writing about.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, this is one of the famous lines in the movie, which is what he wrote was, "All work and no play makes Jack a dull boy."
Right.
And there were just tons of papers written of the same line.
Yeah.
And apparently Stanley Kubrick, who's the director of The Shining, had actually written that on his typewriter.
Ah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, and one thing I forgot to mention was that Stephen King, who wrote The Shining, did not want Jack Nicholson playing the part.
Did you know that? No, I didn't. Who did he want to play?
He wanted an, quote, everyday man.
Mm-hmm. Jack Nicholson isn't?
Well,
no, I know, I'm just joking.
The thing was that Jack Nicholson played a similar character in One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. So, you know, he didn't want to have the audience see Jack Nicholson as that psychotic person. So, anyhow, Stanley Kubrick. It sounds like Stanley Kubrick and Stephen King didn't get along very well.
So, do you know who the other actors were that were thinking about that they wanted to?
No, I don't. Just an everyday man.
So, I have an interesting story about that. So, you've seen the movie A Christmas Story?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so the dad, Darren McGavin, who played the old man, that was his character name. Jack Nicholson was supposed to be that character. That's who they wanted him. They wanted
really?
Him to play the old man. And as good as Jack Nicholson is, I don't think he could have been as good as Darren McGavin.
Mm-hmm.
It just they wouldn't have been the same. That's interesting.
Wow.
Yeah,
I didn't know that.
Yeah, that's
did
what,
you see Christmas Story?
No.
In Portuguese?
Now you're gonna have to see it. Yeah.
Why?
Never mind. Back to Gwendolyn. have you seen the? When's the last time you actually saw The Shining?
It was probably a few years ago.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it still holds up for you in that.
Even seeing the video clips.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and just hearing the red rum.
Oh yeah.
Which, you know, in backwards it was murder. Yeah.
What? No,
never mind. I didn't know that. It killed the movie for me.
Oh.
But it's interesting because Stanley Kubrick let Jack Nicholson improvise. So you know the famous scene where he says, "Here's Johnny."
Yeah.
That was Jack Nicholson's own improvisation.
That happens a lot, though, with movies. So, like, there's little things that aren't written in, and they just become, like, happy accidents, and they're legendary.
So about that movie, you guys know the meaning of the rabbit scene? You know, that is in the room with... It's, what is that? It's a person
The specific room 237?
Yeah, what is that?
I guess apparently there was supposed to be somebody who was killed in that room. And actually the real hotel, which is a hotel in Colorado, they changed the hotel number from 217 to 237.
Ah. Here's Johnny.
Okay, so we have another fabulous roundtable discussion, this time with Josephine and Malin. Well, we seem to go together. I think it's good. Hey. I think this is a nice duo, the dynamic duo. Okay, so Josephine will go first today. So what is your favorite movie villain that is not a superhero?
Yeah, I had a hard time thinking of this one. My brain just kind of froze. I'm sure I have a lot, but I just can't think of them right now.
Okay.
I try to think of, like, my favorite movies, I don't know, The Apartment. So, I mean, there really isn't, like, a villain. Like,
a traditional villain.
Yeah, but when you think of, like, have you guys seen The Apartment?
Oh, of course, yeah.
Yeah, like, when you think of, like, the guy who is kind of, like, the villain.
It's Fred McMurray, right?
McMurray, mm-hmm. Who makes a really great villain because he's so kind of classically handsome, mm-hmm. and very, like, smooth. But in the movie, he's just, like, so ridiculously selfish and just cannot see past his own, like, needs and desires. And I feel like that's, like, the hallmark of most villains, right? They really think that they're right and they just cannot see past anyone else but them. I thought he was really good because it's like he literally thought he was a really great guy. I mean, up until the very, very end. Yeah.
It's interesting about Fred McMurray because way back when, you know, like in Double Indemnity, he played kind of the... Even though Barbara Stanwyck is kind of the femme fatale, but he had a weird career because then he became, you know, doing the Disney movies, mm-hmm. he's doing the Absent-Minded Professor,
yeah, became
and all
like
the Flubber.
A family guy.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And then he was on. What was the TV show he was on? It was like My Favorite Son or something like that, or
Father Knows Best.
I don't think it was Father Knows Best, but it was
Five Sons.
Something like that. But he was basically like the all-American dad, you know,
yeah.
type thing.
Yeah.
So that's a good actor that can do.
Yeah. I mean, stuff. He has that, like, a great look for that kind of, like, role and that kind of character.
Yeah.
And just, yeah, I thought he was so great in that. And then I was just recently watching Working Girl.
Oh, yeah.
And
like,
Sigourney
Weaver
is so great in that, too. She's just so... kind of like underhanded,
mm-hmm.
and I think just like McMurray, she really believes that she's right. And
yeah.
So I feel like that's kind of like a really great like trademark of a good villain is.
Sigourney Weaver's a great one because that reminds me. I'll give away some of my list because the listening audience will already heard it by now. But have you ever seen 9 to 5?
Absolutely.
Mr. Hart is kind of like the epitome of the worst boss ever because
right.
he hates everyone. And Sigourney Weaver's character is not that quite as evil, but not. Not too far off either.
Right.
So, yeah, bosses are always, that's always a fun one. That's
and Mr. Hart comes from like this archetype of 1980s villains,
yes.
maybe, where it's just kind of like the guy who has an obsessive and irrational hatred for some person or group
yeah,
of people.
Yeah, absolutely.
Like there's Mr. Hart, there's
mm-hmm.
the principal
yep.
in Ferris Bueller's Day
oh,
Off.
Oh, yeah,
mm-hmm.
yeah.
Totally irrational
that was
monster.
My number 9.
Yes. Oh, really?
Yeah. Ed Rooney.
How many do we need?
No, you can do it.
Okay.
I did top 10 just because I'm hosting the show and I should have some sort of
oh,
power.
Okay.
But yeah.
Good for you.
Thank
yeah,
you.
Okay.
I know. Yeah.
Then I've got a bar to meet.
Yeah.
Okay.
So Sigourney Weaver, Fred McMurray.
Yeah, and just like, I mean, people that aren't necessarily like evil, like they're like killers or whatever.
Sure.
But just kind of like... They're, you know, stopping the protagonist. They really think that they're right.
Mm-hmm.
They really think that they're well-intentioned.
Sure.
It's just, I mean, I love Sigourney Weaver in Working Girl just because she is so slippery.
Yeah, oh, yeah.
And really good at, like, moving the chess pieces.
Yeah.
Which is not necessarily a bad quality, but it's just, I mean, that's kind of what I love, that she's so well-matched with Melanie Griffith's
yeah.
character, who's a little bit naive, but she's just as smart. And, yeah, I loved it.
And
yeah.
if I remember correctly, she turns the tables really nicely at the end, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
yeah. Yeah.
It makes the payoff that much better.
Nice.
So, yeah.
yeah.
All right. So, Maywin.
Okay. This is tough because my brain is a bit of a jumble today. But I tend to... the villains that I tend to remember the most and that really get deep-seated into my psyche are the sympathetic ones.
Mm-hmm.
Or the villains where you don't realize that they're a villain. During the movie or when you leave the movie, but when you think back, you're like, oh, wait, that was the person who is really screwed up.
Yeah.
So, in that respect, I think one of my favorite villains is Seymour Crowborn,
mm-hmm.
who's the hero in scare quotes, of Little Shop of Horrors. But really, if you look at that movie, it's kind of complicated because there are two versions. There's the one that was, they filmed it originally so that it would follow the musical.
Mm-hmm.
So basically it's this plant teaching this guy to be a serial killer.
Yeah.
It's a fledgling serial
mm-hmm.
killer, and he gets his comeuppance at the end. He gets eaten by the plant. And then the plant takes over the world. That's great. However, the test audiences didn't like it. They changed the ending, so it's a happy ending. And so the moral of the theatrical version is that a particularly 1950s heteronormative married family life in a little cottage out with a beautiful lawn will sanitize, like, the worst sins ever.
Sure.
You know? So I think he's great. And the songs are fantastic, so you can't fault that movie.
So which version do you like the best?
The one that sticks to the Broadway version.
Okay.
Because now I just don't buy it. I have a real hard time when I get to the end of a movie and they just package it up with a marriage and then the credits roll. And you're like, you're supposed to, like, just imagine the best things ever happen.
Now, have you seen the actual play and like in the theater? Or
oh yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Actually, even worse than that, when it came time, I think it was my senior year in high school.
Mm-hmm.
I'd been in drama for the previous 2 years, and the music instructor didn't know what he wanted to do that year. It was just like, we should do Little Shop of Horrors, and we did.
That's awesome.
Can you guess which character I played?
Plant?
No, I didn't. I played the dentist who happens to be
the Steve Martin
character. Yeah, the Steve Martin character who's actually who you're supposed to think is like the villain.
Right.
The people that Plant eats, those are supposed to be the villains.
Mm-hmm.
Mushnick, the dentist.
Yeah.
No. It's the guy who's feeding those people. He's the one who's really evil. He's got like no moral compass, or if he does, it is so whacked out that he's just like plant food. okay, so some other ones. Norman Bates. There's one who...
That's my number 10.
So low on your list.
I know, it was too hard. Because he's a villain, but you feel bad for him.
Exactly,
that's
why I kind of love him. It's because you begin to really relate to the character. I think that's just, when you think about how Hitchcock set that up, people are going into this movie, and if they've seen the trailer, they already know pretty much what's going to happen.
Yeah.
He kind of spelled it out for them.
Mm-hmm.
Even still, you go into that movie, you don't know which lefts and rights it's going to take. And when I saw it as a teenager, I was shocked.
Yeah.
I was totally shocked. But by the time you find out, or by the time that all of your worst fears are verified about Norman Bates, you already are like so on his side, and you just feel bad for the poor creep.
Yeah.
You know, so and then he goes off and jail, and you're like, whoa.
Yes.
I don't know how I feel about that, which is great. I think that's the mark of a brilliant villain, is when you leave the movie, you don't really know how you feel about that character, and it kind of forces you to question, oh, what is my dark kind of inner nature doing in there?
Right.
Why is it kind of relating to this kind of horrific aspect of this fictional
character?
Well,
that's why the ending's great, too, because it's not his voice. It's the mom's voice.
Exactly.
That's
such a brilliant turn. Hannibal Lecter is the obvious one.
Yep. I think that's number 5. Yeah. So you're getting a lot of mine, so that's good.
I would have reversed.
Well, Danielle said Buffalo Bill, because she actually likes Hannibal.
Well, that's why I pick Hannibal was because you like him.
Yeah.
Never mind the fact that building up to the end of the movie, this is interesting to me because he has one of the most horrific scenes in the film when he's in the ambulance and you have that reveal. I don't want to spoil too much of it, but there's this one shot in that ambulance that is horrifying.
Yeah.
And he's nothing but a deep, dark, psychopathic monster. Not even just a villain, but a monster.
Sure.
But by the time you get to the end of the film, it takes this twist, and you're exploring kind of the inner psyche of this very unsympathetic, I think, sociopathic psycho killer. So when you come back to Hannibal Lecter, somehow he's the good guy again.
Yeah.
Brilliant movie.
Yeah.
Brilliant.
I mean, they made Buffalo Bill to be so creepy and so despicable that even someone like Hannibal Lecter is like, okay, I can see making the deal with the devil.
Yeah, so much that you're like, oh yeah, I want him to get the guy at the end.
Yeah.
And you'd be like, oh, I wish I could have dinner with that guy. He seems so smart and interesting.
I remember when I saw that, I was really young. But then I was just like, well, I like that he decided not to kill Jodie Foster.
Right? That's almost like enough to humanize her at that point. You're like, whoa.
It's just because she's just as smart as he is in your respects.
Absolutely.
It's like, oh, thank God.
I wish.
Don't read the follow-up book then.
Okay.
It's really too bad that Jodie Foster wasn't in the sequels. I mean, all respect to Joanne Moore, it just isn't the same.
But did you, if you read the sequel book, I think it probably explains why she wasn't on board for that, and they probably changed the ending after they were in production.
You're right.
I don't think Foster would have gone through with it with the book's ending.
Right. Mm. Did you ever see Manhunter, which was the original?
Yeah, I did, but long time ago.
Yeah, it's not bad, but it's like if you've seen Silence of the Lambs first, it's weird watching.
It's hard to separate.
Yeah.
Yeah, I had that kind of disconnect. I was like, I don't know.
Yeah, it's just funny seeing the guy from, what's that, CSI, as William Peterson, as the main character, because he's basically the Jodie Foster character.
Oh, I don't know.
Yeah, it's interesting. It's on Netflix. So. Yeah, I think it came out in 86, 87. See, Malin's got this huge list. See, that's the I like people that come from.
I just jotted it down here, but I've been thinking about it a little bit. Jack Torrance from The Shining. So the father, which is horrifying. So I find zombies horrifying because it's especially when you get to a scene where you have two people. You know, eventually you always have like a mother and a son, and the son doesn't want to kill the mother or whatever. And Shaun and the Dead, it's the guy, Shaun doesn't want to kill his mother,
right,
or his stepfather, actually kind of does, but he really doesn't want to kill his mother.
Yeah.
So there's that horrible disconnect of someone that you love with all of your heart having absolutely no understanding of who you are to the point where they're bent on your destruction, which is horrible, and it has allegories with real life, obviously. And then in The Shining, Jack Torrance, I saw that as a kid. That was horrifying. I think that was one of the first films when I saw, before even a zombie film, when I saw that your family could be a source of deep, dark, psychological horror.
Yeah.
And that was really, really disturbing. Even seeing a really, really heavily cut version late at night on TV as a kid.
You didn't put that as your favorite horror movie either, or scary movie?
No, I told you.
Yeah.
No, but the thing was with the scary movies was what was the first scary movie you saw, right?
It was both. It could have been favorite scary movie too, so.
Well, the first one, it was The Elephant Man.
Yeah.
After I thought about it and realized it was The Elephant Man. Okay. Yeah. And I'm going to skip this one because you've probably already touched on Annie Wilkes.
No.
From Misery?
Danielle picked her, but you can please give me your take on that.
Oh, she's messed up. She's just messed up. Yeah, and you just feel bad for her. She's so kind of out of control and
entitled, too.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like, lady... Like, you don't own the character and you don't own the author. You know what I mean?
Right.
It's just like she really felt like she was entitled to this, and it's just, it just got blown, obviously, so out of proportion.
Yeah, the entitlement and the jealousy and the, that weird relationship that she builds, like that bond that a caregiver and an infirm person would build, but takes it to such an insane level. That's such a vulnerable relationship, and then through her misunderstanding of what she means to him and what he means to her and where the character is between them and where fiction and nonfiction is separated between them, because she's kind of devolved into his relationship to that character and him killing it off in any way.
Yeah.
And her becoming, like, not just caregiver, but, like, a judge.
Yeah.
And
mm-hmm.
trial and jury.
See, I thought you were going to go with Christine, the car.
No.
If you're
going to
pick Stephen King,
I
know.
No, I wouldn't. I would never probably think of a car movie or a sports movie.
No, just
because
Stephen King.
As soon as you do a sports movie, I was like, I'm going to tap out.
You can find something in sports.
Okay, and so I have one.
Okay.
Irrational, kind of like the irrational, psychopathic, like you can't really relate to them, but they're truly deeply, deeply creepy on a level that I think touched a lot of people's subconscious
mm-hmm.
fears of the irrational. Killer Bob from Twin Peaks.
Mm, yeah.
That's a good one.
Yeah.
Because we were talking about David Lynch and how just, like, I feel like a lot of his movies, they're meant to, like, unsettle you, trigger something in you. I mean, because his movies, they exist kind of in the real world, but obviously something else is going on, and I feel like that's a really scary part. It's like you're not really sure what the hell is going on, but I feel like he kind of taps into this part of you that triggers, like, the deep, dark, like,
mm-hmm.
fears and nature of people, you know, and,
absolutely. When he gets his hook into you, from whatever angle it happens to be, he tends to cut deep. You know, it might be, the emotion might be joy, happiness, fear, whatever, but he tends to tap very deeply.
Yeah.
I had actually thought about doing, like, a villain from each of his films. I'm obsessed with David Lynch.
We can do
a David
Lynch episode. And then,
Thank you.
You can, you can do
not
everything.
Gonna,
yeah.
No,
take
I'm not going
yeah.
to
yeah.
host it. I wouldn't
I have no problem.
But I didn't want to do that because then it'd be like, oh, man, I don't want to come off as like a total, like, David Lynch wonk. Like, there is more to my, like, world. You know?
I thought of one more.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, as you were talking, I thought. Cause I can't believe I just thought of this because I was just watching it last night.
Yeah.
It was Bob Ewell in To Kill a Mockingbird.
Oh,
that's a good one.
That's a good one.
Yeah.
I think just maybe it's the election that's coming up and, like, all the craziness that's going on with that. But, again, like, I think he just really thinks that he's right. And I think Gregory Peck's character, Atticus Finch, he makes a really good point. He's talking about his daughter, about how, like, but I think it applies to him, too, which is she's just the product of ignorance and poverty.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just that's kind of what fuels him. It's just, you know what I mean? It's just...
Yeah.
Yeah, and then I remember just watching the end, like, you know what happens in the end. You're just like, God, the people are crazy, you know?
All right, we have Terry on the podcast again, who's a longtime veteran, and she's always great on the show. So for this week, we're going to do movie villains that aren't superheroes.
Mm-hmm.
So what do you got for me this week?
Oh, well, there's a lot of them, and they were all from James Bond movies.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I actually don't remember all of their names because they have some special characters about them.
Right.
So
you have the main guy who's like the leader of Spectre.
Yes.
And then obviously Oddjob, who throws his hat and he's got the blade in it. And Jaws with the metal teeth.
Yes.
Those are all good ones.
Those metal teeth are scary.
Those are hard to pick because you need a good villain.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so what was the other one that you had?
I also really like Samuel L. Jackson
mm-hmm.
in the movie Kingsman.
Yeah, that was a fun movie.
Yes. So his partner was that lady with the metal knife, like feet that looks like metal.
Yeah.
Knife.
Yep.
Yeah. And so I like him in that movie because... he's actually very funny in that movie. So it was actually very hilarious, really crazy, funny, but at the same time, he was a bad guy.
Yeah. Well, it's kind of like in Pulp Fiction, we were talking about everyone in Pulp Fiction is kind of bad. It's like, who is less bad?
Uh-huh.
But even then, he plays a hitman.
Uh-huh.
So even though you're rooting for him, he's still not a good guy, him and John Travolta. So, those Samuel L. Jackson's good and everything.
He really is.
Yes.
I agree.
Those are great.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, Terry.
Thank you, Brian.
Thanks to everyone that was interviewed. It was another great time had by all. Just some housekeeping so that we can go through things that we may have forgot while we were recording this. The person that played Darth Vader was Adam Driver. This was in the new Star Wars. Gwendolyn remembered after she was interviewed about Jack Nicholson that she forgot to mention that Jack Torrance, which was the character in The Shining, ranked as the 25th villain among AFI's 100 Greatest Villains. We had to make sure that we got that one in there. And of course, I have plenty of leftovers of honorable mentions of who I could have had on my list, but I, for whatever reason, left off. So two of the good ones, they kind of coincide together, and I'll start with the older one first, which is Jessica Walter, who played Play Misty for Me. And so if you've ever seen Play Misty for Me, it's kind of the precursor to Fatal Attraction. This was Clint Eastwood's directorial debut, and it's basically about a woman who, after a one-night stand, thinks that the relationship is much more, and the male doesn't feel that way, and then she basically terrorizes him, which then leads to Glenn Close's character in Fatal Attraction, also with Michael Douglas. So, you know, they, while it's tough to call them a villain because they've been scorned in their own way, you could construe them as villains. You also have, as a fun one, you could have Joe Pesci and Daniel Stern as the wet bandits in the hilarious movie Home Alone. You know, they really did well as the duo. You have Arnold Schwarzenegger as the Terminator in the original Terminator. But then that gets tricky because then he becomes the good Terminator in Terminator 2. And after a while, I started thinking about it, and I'm like, I'm leaving him off the list. Sorry about that. Another fun one is Shooter McGavin in the movie Happy Gilmore. Again, it's a funny movie, but he does play a real asshole. But, you know, it just makes the payoff that much better when Happy beats him in the golf tournament. In general, Gene Hackman played some great villains. The one that comes to mind the most is in the movie Absolute Power, where he plays a congressman. I believe he's a congressman. And he gets caught killing his mistress while Clint Eastwood, the jewel thief, who happens to be robbing him at the same time, is witnessing the whole thing. And again, Gene Hackman, one of the greatest actors of all time. And lastly, keeping up with the Rocky theme, someone asked, well, why didn't you pick Ivan Drago instead of Mr. T? Well, Mr. T was first, and I love Mr. T, so I had to go with him. But Ivan Drago definitely deserved to be one of the greatest villains. That being said, he barely says anything, which just makes him, I mean, it really what makes him a villain is the 80s propaganda of him being Russian, even though he's not really Russian in real life, and just him being so menacing. And then, of course, he was taking steroids in the movie, so, you know, we're all anti-steroid even back then because Rocky does it the hard way, even though, ironically, I'm pretty sure Sylvester Stallone took steroids probably during the making of Rocky, but that's okay. We can suspend belief. Anyway, this was a lot of fun. I hope you enjoyed it as well. Again, check us out on iTunes, and I say this every week, but we want to promote this as much as possible, and the best way to do that is to leave a review and to rate our show. So by doing that, we'll get boosted in the algorithm and more people can hear this wonderful stuff. You can also check us out at Podbeam at damngoodmoviememories.podbean.com. You can check out our Facebook page for Damn Good Movie Memories. And of course, we also have a YouTube page for Damn Good Movie Memories. All right, until next week, this is Brian signing off.
The moment I wake up before I put on my makeup, I say a little prayer for you, and that's it.